The following is an audiobook presentation of Ben Stone's Sedition, Subversion, and Sabotage, Field Manual No. 1, a three-part solution to this state, produced by Liberty Under Attack Publications. To view all of our free PDFs and audiobooks, please visit tinyurl.com/LUA publications. Again, tinyurl.com/LUA publications. This was a volunteer effort by many folks. Without it, this important project would have been delayed for some time. Narrators include Melissa Rakovich, Dave Driscoll,
Diana Kyler,
Jeremy Hangler, Merrick Van Landingham, Mark Taylor, Travis McQuivy, Kyle Reardon, and Shane Radliff. Make sure to go thank Ben for his work on putting this together. Find him on Twitter at BadQuakerBen and his website, badquaker.com. Please enjoy. Sedition, Subversion, and Sabotage, Field Manual No. 1, a three-part solution to this state. A collaborative effort by the Office of Sedition, Subversion, and Sabotage, OSSSS, and the LEGO Distribution Network, LDN. Printing and distribution authorized by the Harm and Husband v. Preservation Committee. Part 1, Peaceful Sedition. Ben Quaker, Naughtonshire, South Coast Free District. Part 2, Simple Sabotage. Prepared under the guidance of the Director of Agitation and Aggravation, Grigori Rasputin V, with extensive team support for research, testing, and Americanized grammar. LDN Darknet Branch, Yefimovich, Pokrovskoy, Free Oblast. Part 3, Ethics-Based Selective Irregular Warfare. Prepared under the guidance of the Committee of Vigilance in conjunction with the Orange Free Regulators and the remaining elders of the Baldknobbers. LDN Darknet Branch, Bavarian Gulch, Ozark Free District. Authoritarian Disclaimer. This manual should always be referred to as a work of fiction, as a poor attempt at humor, as political satire, and as a parody of the 1944 OSS publication Simple Sabotage Field Manual, not to be taken seriously. The distribution and contents of this manual should be controlled, and efforts should be made to keep it from falling into the hands of the immature, the authoritarian, or any other childish types that may not have the mental capacity to tolerate alternative viewpoints. Any representative of authority who would try to use this work as evidence in a criminal case should be mocked and shamed for not being intelligent enough to get the joke. This should not be difficult since, as we all know, those who tend to be authoritarian are usually so self-absorbed with their own inflated ego that there is no room in their tiny sad soul for humor. After all, who would seriously object to having wonderful overlords such as those provided to us by our benevolent governments and their crony superstructure? No one would ever actually want anything bad to happen to anyone in authority. We all love our political masters. This product is covered by a BIPCOT NoGov license. Use and reuse by anyone except governments or their agents is granted. Further use permission. This product is purposefully not a registered ISBN product. Please feel free to use, reuse, distribute, copy, reprint, take credit for, steal, broadcast, mock, hate, quote, misquote, or modify this product in any way you see fit. Sell it, make copies and hand it out at concerts, make t-shirts, print it on flying discs, or do anything else because intellectual property is a state-based haven of the weak, the stupid, and those lacking confidence in their own ability. Part 1. Peaceful Sedition. Chapter 1. The Purpose is Not. Many books, articles, and scholarly papers will begin with some kind of statement of the case, an introduction to the topic, or a synopsis of the concept being proposed. Additionally, the underlying purpose of almost every such writing is to convert someone to, or convince someone of, the author's viewpoint. I won't be doing that. First and foremost, the purpose of this field manual is not to convert or convince anyone of anything. This manual is written for those who already accept its premise and are, or soon will be actively engaging in matters of the kind or similar to those covered in the manual. The purpose of this manual is to create an overview of why these actions will take place as a record for posterity, and to train and prepare those who take such actions to do them as wisely and as safely as possible. Additionally, included in this manual is information that the activist may use to help explain why he or she is taking the path they have chosen to follow. This information is not intended to be an exhaustive work of reference. It is simply a first step in arming and training our friends for the unfortunate and difficult task that is before us. It is intended to be modified and expanded as new information arrives and as the need develops. My only goal in assembling this manual is to share the wisdom I have learned from my own successes and failures over the years, and share that which I have learned from my mentors, as well as what I have learned from observing the foolish and their repeated and predictable follies. Those who have a mind to listen and apply my words to their activism will do so by their choice, not because of a sales tactic or some emotional plea. The truth of my words will ring in their ears like a tuning fork to the musician, or it will miss it altogether. So if you thought you could use this book as an evangelical tool to give to your friends to convince them that roads can exist without governments, you are mistaken. This is not an introduction to libertarian thought, nor is it an anarchist primer. This is a field manual for winning a war against the enemy of humanity, the state. Just for the record, I am a grandfather, I am a Quaker, I am a minister, and I am bound by no oath of allegiance. I am not a pacifist, however, I respect pacifists and would never try to persuade them to change. I believe in the zero aggression principle, and I believe I have a responsibility to protect myself and those closest to me with whatever means, including violent and even deadly measures as the need arises. As a Quaker, I feel no obligation to attempt to convert anyone to any viewpoint. Therefore, I do not support evangelism, neither on religious nor philosophical topics. I believe every thinking adult should know what they believe and why they believe it, and I believe every thinking adult should be prepared to explain their beliefs in a logical and consistent manner. Likewise, I don't believe in any obligation to explain anything to anyone. If I choose to speak, I will speak the truth as I know it. If you choose to heed my words, then do so. If my words offend you, don't read them. For the last 38 years, I have resisted, opposed, or openly fought the state as best as I could with the knowledge and resources I had at my disposal. Much of those efforts were misguided and wrong-headed. Some were downright foolish. I often took the route proposed by those most influential in the movement at the time. Thus, I voted for prominent libertarian leaders, donated to their campaigns and causes, bought their books, attended their speeches, supported their websites and institutes, and generally parroted what they taught. I embraced counter-economics and agorism by living entirely off-grid in the Mojave Desert while supporting myself through black market activity and paying as little in taxes as possible. I ran an above-ground, unlicensed business in Reno, Nevada and a highly regulated industry. I taught myself hacking techniques and ran an MP3 sharing server on a NASA computer before Napster existed. I took my children out of school and rejected the homeschooling curriculum before the word unschooling was invented. In short, if a libertarian or market anarchist has taught a method for obtaining freedom, I have either tried it or I have closely observed others trying it. It is with this body of experience that I present my conclusion. The so-called liberty movement is doing it wrong. With the exception of some Bitcoin activists and some computer hackers, those people most celebrated with fame and recognition in the liberty movement are usually deeply committed to one or two of the four conventional strategies that have been proven over and over to be either marginally successful at best or outright counterproductive. More on the four conventional strategies later. Typically, this fact is ignored by the wide-eyed followers of those dynamic personalities that flutter about selling these worn-out methods. Therefore, we have this field manual not for those still transfixed by the celebrity libertarian evangelists, nor those with their minds stuck in dusty old books and worn-out methods, but for those who have come to the same conclusion that I have. Doing the same things over and over expecting different results while viciously defending old field methods is both foolish and tiresome to watch. I expect most people who begin to read this book will reject it outright as soon as they realize that the premise is not to only encourage specific violent actions, but to teach peaceful people how and when to safely and wisely commit those actions. Of course, I am speaking of staying within the zero aggression principle, and I am talking about respecting individual private property, but I am also specifically addressing the fictions of public property and government property, and I am talking about violent and sometimes bloody self-defense, along with disciplined preemptive self-defense. Over the last 150 years, a number of well-known anarchists have advocated some type of violence as a method of achieving freedom, including several prominent libertarian or market-type anarchists from as early as the 1960s. However, in each of these, there was some flaw in either principle or in method of execution. Perhaps their plan was vague, or it depended upon some rounding up cattle car type government actions to spark the event, or perhaps there was a blaring lack of forethought and wisdom in the planning, or it depended upon revolution, which, as history plainly shows, only results in a new government. So, without dwelling on failures of the past, and in order to develop a plan for victory, we must consider that people are different, and there is no dishonor in that difference. The vast majority of liberty activists are and should remain peaceful. They should endeavor to develop self-control in the face of oppression and resist the urge to lash out at our captors. Again, there is no dishonor in peacefulness. The first section of this manual is aimed at the majority of activists, the ones I refer to as the above ground. Then again, there are those who simply cannot control their urge to physically resist the authoritarians. Perhaps they aren't suited for actual warfare, but they certainly cannot restrain their actions to the realm of speech. This group of activists are the ones who should take careful note of the next section of this manual, titled Simple Sabotage. And then there is the tiny minority that do not fit in either of the above categories. They are the few who need to read the final section of this manual, titled Irregular Warfare. Thus, we have this three-part field manual that you hold before you. It is not for everyone. It is targeted at those who need to read it, and all others should openly and loudly denounce it. Every above-ground activist that reads this book should, after finishing it, proclaim it heresy, deny its validity, and then pass it on to that one person you know that needs it.
Chapter 2. Definitions. Any complex conversation worth having should first rest upon a set of definitions. No debate, no agreement, and no lasting trust can be secured without the parties involved understanding the definitions of the words being used. The following definitions will be used throughout the three parts of this field manual, not so that you can like or agree with these definitions, but so that the definitions in the context of this manual can be consistently understood. 2.1. Sedition. Sedition is overt conduct or speech, inciting or provoking people to rebel or resist authority, especially that of the state or of a specific governing body. In other words, it is that which happens in plain sight of our enemy. Sedition can involve violent or nonviolent actions or speech. 2.1.1. Propaganda. Generally, propaganda is information, especially of a biased nature, used to promote a cause or a point of view. The word propaganda typically carries with it the assumption that something is false or misleading. This doesn't have to be the case. Propaganda can be false or entirely true, but what makes propaganda different from other forms of communication is that propaganda is information used specifically to change the way people think or to move the conversation in a specific direction. 2.2. Subversion. Subversion is an attempt to transform the established social order and its structures of power, authority, and hierarchy. Subversion refers to a process by which the values and principles of a system in place are questioned, contradicted, or reversed, usually through underhanded processes, as opposed to open belligerency. In other words, it is that which happens without our enemy seeing. Subversion can involve violent or nonviolent actions or speech. 2.3. Sabotage. Sabotage is a deliberate action aimed at weakening a polity or corporation through subversion, obstruction, disruption, or destruction. Sabotage can range from intentionally doing poorly at a job, to creating a disruptive atmosphere among workers by questioning managers, to actively destroying property. The word sabotage has its roots in the practice of peasant workers shoving their shoes into the gears of factories. Sabotage can involve violent or nonviolent actions or speech. 2.3.1. Friend Saboteur. A fellow anarchist, abolitionist, voluntarist who embraces the zero aggression principle and rejects all forms of coercive slavery while actively employing the methods of simple sabotage in resistance of the state and its actors. 2.4. Ethics-based irregular warfare. Irregular warfare favors indirect and asymmetric warfare approaches, though it may employ the full range of military and other capabilities in order to erode an adversary's power, influence, and will. It is often defined as a protracted struggle by an indigenous people testing the resolve of an occupying government and its strategic partners. It can take the form of insurgency or terrorism, but does not necessarily manifest itself as such in all cases. Ethics-based irregular warfare rejects the use of violence against the non-combatant and their property, and favors strategic selective engagement with those considered highly valued or highly aggressive targets. 2.5. Insurgency. An insurgency is a struggle against authority when those taking part in the struggle are not universally recognized as belligerents. Insurgents are often indigenous people resisting the existing authority or government. An insurgency can involve violent or nonviolent actions or speech. 2.6. The state. In the context of this manual, the state is capitalized as a personal pronoun rather than its simple legal definition as a noun. The state is the entity, deity, real or imagined, that all aspects of all coercive governments, along with key corporations, the central banking complex, the mainstream media, the mainstream intelligentsia, and mainstream clergy serve as their master. This includes the so-called shadow governments and all those behind the scenes who intentionally facilitate the dominance of humanity through the use of violence and threats of violence coupled with theft and lies. One could say the state is the mystical character, Angelus of the body politic. 2.7. The Great Man. The concept of the Great Man was heavily debated and debunked in the 1800s, but the belief is as old as the state itself and is more widely accepted today than ever. The basic idea is that God, or nature's God, provides special great men at specific times to lead society or governments during crisis, or to advance the progress of humanity towards a greater civilization. In reality, the great man theory is nothing but the old divine right of King's myth, modified with modern terminology. The other half of the great man theory that is rarely addressed is the boogeyman. He is the opposite of the great man. He is standing in the shadows, always waiting to take over and destroy civilization as soon as people fail to follow the great man. He is Hannibal at the gates. He is the next Hitler. He is the great Satan, always poised to steal men's minds and souls held at bay only by the wisdom and bravery of the great man. In American politics, the great man boogeyman has developed into an art form. Every 4 years, a macabre opera is played out at the cost of billions of dollars, almost $7 billion in 2012, according to OpenSecrets.org, as the American people attempt to determine who will be the great man and who will fail to raise to the calling. Of course, the whole idea of the great man boogeyman is pure poppycock and is the invisible thread that holds together the emperor's new clothes. The moment you realize there is no great man and there is no boogeyman, the emperor's clothing vanishes and you see him for the tiny wart-covered leech that he is. 2.8. Centralized, decentralized, and distributed networks. The standard definitions are used in this case based on the 121-page paper Paul Barron wrote for the RAND Corporation in 1964. In brief summary, imagine a bicycle wheel with spokes protruding from a central hub. Now remove the tire and rim, leaving only the hub in the middle with the spokes protruding outward. At the end of each spoke is an activist. This would be a centralized network of activists. All of the activists are connected to the same central hub. If anything happens to the hub, the entire network is affected. Now imagine 5 or 10 or any other number of small hubs with some spokes on each hub connecting to the other hubs. All of the hubs can function independently, so if one hub is taken out of the network still mostly functions. But in taking out the one hub, you have also taken out all of the spokes and activists that depended on that hub. This is a decentralized network of activists. It is more reliable than a centralized network, but still relies on hubs. Now imagine all of the hubs are gone, leaving only spokes and activists. The activists connect not to one spoke and one hub, but each activist has 2 to 5 spokes or more, each connected to other activists. No activist is a hub, and yet all activists are hubs. No one activist depends solely on another activist, while all activists are within 2 or 3 connections from any other activist. This is a distributed network of activists. The word activist is used here, but the concept is the same if you use the word computer or telephone or soup can. 2.9. Activism, activist. Some very small-minded people believe activism is narrowly defined as only including the activity that they approve of. Others believe that any action you take, no matter the intent or outcome, is positive activism that should be praised and supported. I call both those types of people stupid. If you take action, you are an activist. Your activism may be useful or useless. It may be wise or foolish. It may be dramatic or calming. It may do what you expect, or it may not. Talking is activism. Posting catchy pictures with snappy sayings on social media is activism. Handcuffing yourself to the door of a police station is activism. Pouring gasoline on your head and igniting it on the courthouse steps is activism. Activism is not defined by the intent nor the results of the action. Activism is defined as action taken for a purpose. Judging the wisdom or the efficacy of activism is a completely different matter. 2.10. Slacktivism. Some newer definitions for slacktivism are derogatory perversions of its original meaning. For the purposes of this manual, socktivism is defined closer to its original positive meaning. This manual defines socktivism, for example, in an employment setting, as intentionally doing a really bad job while not doing anything bad enough to get fired. A specific example of socktivism would be a trash collector who only half empties the trash cans of select customers for the purpose of disrupting the day-to-day functions of that specific customer. Or a waiter could find himself too busy helping one customer with minor issues to attend to the basic needs of an important customer who is the target of the socktivism. In customer service, a socktivist may waste the target's time going over details, having them repeat information, apologizing over and over, while either not solving the target's problems or taking longer than required to solve it. In the immortal words of Homer Simpson, "Lisa, if you don't like your job, you don't go on strike. You just go in every day and do it really half-assed." 2.11. Corporation. According to the United States government, U.S. Small Business Administration, a corporation is an independent legal entity. This means that the corporation itself is held legally liable for the actions and debts of the business. Additionally, the Supreme Court of the United States has ruled that a corporation is a legal person. The legal person status of corporations give the business perpetual life. Deaths of officials or stockholders do not alter the corporation. And the SCOTUS has ruled that corporations, like humans, have certain rights that are protected by the U.S. Constitution. I may not like this definition, and you may not like this definition. Too bad. This is how the U.S. government sees it, and most other governments largely agree. Therefore, this is how the word will be used in this manual. You may like corporations, or you may hate them. It doesn't matter.
Section 1, Chapter 3. Know your enemy, know yourself. Chapter 3, Section 1. Your enemy, the faithful and obedient. The state itself is explained several other times in this book, so there is no need to repeat it here. Rather, I will concentrate on the real problem, those who believe in and act on behalf of the state. It is particularly difficult for an honest, peaceful person to understand and anticipate the acts of those whose minds are absorbed in evil, dominance, and power, or those committed to obey such monsters. Oftentimes, the most difficult task an abolitionist anarchist faces is explaining the deeds of state actors in a way that it is believable to good, honest people. They tend to think that we're not being truthful, or they think we believe some crazy conspiracy theory, or they think we're confused or delusional. Knowing the facts and having specific references available helps in explaining evil acts to good people. As explained elsewhere in this book, most of the time a good person simply cannot believe how evil state actors can be until they experience it firsthand, and even then many will remain in denial, believing that there must be some simple mistake that caused the tragic events they're experiencing. It would be impossible for me to provide an exhaustive list and vivid description of the evil that has taken place in the last generation or two. Incredible evil has happened simply because people were obedient to the orders of their state masters. Also, there are thousands of other voices shouting this information from every direction. So again, there is no need to list them all here. All a person has to do is look for themselves as the stories are unending. So with that in mind, I would like to tell some stories that are less spoken of but are examples that we can look at and learn of the nature of those whose minds are so warped by their faith in the state that they would do that which is unthinkable and then believe it to be justified. Chapter 3, Section 1.1. Murder Without a Trace. An alternative use for the active denial system, a millimeter wave source weapon. What you are about to read is not science fiction. Understanding the nature of our enemy is critical to understanding the level of evil to which our enemy is capable. Likewise, understanding the tools our enemy has available allows us to become aware of what our enemy is physically capable of achieving. Chapter 3, Section 1.1.01. What will they do? We know without question that individuals acting on behalf of the United States government routinely murder innocent men, women, and children in foreign lands under the guise of the war on terror. We also know without question that individuals acting on behalf of that same government routinely cage, beat, rob, and murder innocent men, women, and children within the geographic boundaries of the U.S. under the excuse of the war on drugs, or sometimes simply for resisting police. We also know without question that the U.S. government and its local subsidiaries routinely prefer to employ badged and uniformed psychopathic morons, half-wits, and thugs to do the bidding of those holding positions of power. We can surmise that those who hold positions of power within all governments will take extreme measures to maintain their positions of power. This lethal combination of power-hungry politicians, bureaucrats, and other government actors, along with hyper-patriotic soldiers and police of sub-average intelligence, added to the legendary levels of institutional incompetency that government agencies are so well known for, caused the casual observer to recognize government as a constant threat to human life. During the debate over the militarization of local police departments within the U.S., one outstanding argument against applying military armament to police was based on the nature of people to use the weapons and equipment supplied to them, even when such tools and tactics are not necessary. Thus, we have situations in the U.S. where local police use MRAP or mine-resistant ambush-protected vehicles and military assault tactics to deliver such things as warrants or traffic and parking violations. The result of providing police with military-grade weapons is that police will look for the opportunity to use and justify the possession of that military equipment. This argument is identical to warnings given years ago when the Transportation Safety Administration, TSA, began to deploy airport security tactics that included inappropriate touching and searching of travelers. It was just a matter of time until inspectors with that authority would abuse such authority on a growing scale. And this is exactly what happened. Taking this argument a step further, during the 1950s, through at least the mid-1970s, the CIA ran a number of projects that are well documented to have fallen into the same tendency of abuse. CIA operatives were actively engaged in mind control experiments using powerful drugs, and their victims ranged from important political figures to random people encountered by agents in everyday activities, like lunching at a cafe. This being the documented behavior of CIA operatives, logic dictates that we can expect similar behavior from NSA agents today. Realizing the tendency that given new toys, children will play new games, we must assume that anyone who garners the attention of the wrong NSA agent could be the victim of any weapon or tactic that such agents would be in possession of at any particular time. One deadly myth that permeates the minds of freedom activists is the idea that only famous people can be singled out as a target of the NSA. No matter that volumes of government security information leaked in recent years directly contradicts this myth, most anarchists and liberty activists seem to accept as dogma the silly notion that they are safe and their friends are safe, simply because some famous activist has done dramatic acts of protest and has never been assaulted by the NSA. An aspect of this myth is the almost universal acceptance that the NSA uses some kind of ranking order to decide what liberty celebrity is to be scrutinized. Then, when someone publicly states that they are being watched or bothered by authorities, some liberty celebrity who feels they rank higher will dismiss the lesser libertarian's claim. How ridiculous. Would anyone believe speeding tickets or random acts of violence by police are done by some ranking order? This incredibly dangerous state of denial is a combination of ignorance of the nature of authoritarians and a deep-seated fear of facing the facts when it comes to exactly how evil our enemy is. In saying this, I'm not trying to use fear as a motivating factor. I'm trying to educate good people who simply can't seem to get their head around the fact that we're dealing with authoritarians who will single out anyone who comes into the crosshair of their scope. They don't care what celebrity ranking you feel that you deserve, because the agent who is likely to single you out hasn't spent countless hours figuring out a who's who of the people you think are important. I like to think of dealing with the NSA as very much the same as hiking in a swamp. I write this from a campground in the deep southeastern United States, where there are wide swamps filled with all kinds of dangerous creatures. Within a 5-minute walk of my camp, I could encounter a bobcat, a coyote, a rattlesnake, a cottonmouth viper, fire ants, or a hungry alligator. None of these creatures would treat me kindly. Yet I hike every day in these swamps because I love them. I do not need to be afraid, but the reason I don't fear is because I am aware of the danger, and I know how to protect myself in any situation. Therefore, I am motivated by knowledge, not fear. Blindly believing the NSA won't target you because you aren't famous is like walking through a swamp without being aware of the dangers. An alligator, like an NSA agent, should be treated as a simple-minded predator who will strike anything within its reach, and the facts support this comparison. Chapter 3, Section 1.1.02. What can they do? The Range R is a handheld device that can be used to see through walls, including reinforced concrete. It has a 50-foot range and sells for about $6,000 as of the date of this writing. From a legal case being heard in Denver, Colorado at the time of this writing, we know that at least 50 local police agencies possess and use the Range R device. It can be used to see through floors, doors, and walls, and can detect human movement. It can see the heat of a live human body and can distinguish between a human body and other heat-producing items in a room. So, for example, the Range R can be used in a hotel or apartment to monitor the position and movement of a specific subject in a room directly above, below, or beside the room containing the authoritarian. In addition to the Range R, for at least the last 3 years, the New York Police Department has had two or more unmarked vans equipped with surveillance devices that allow the NYPD to see through cars and buildings from the street. The U.S. Customs and Border Protection also uses vans of this type, as well as other agencies of the Department of Homeland Security. It is known that they have been deployed at the Republican National Convention and the Super Bowl. These vans are produced by American Science and Engineering Incorporated, and it can be reasonably assumed that other police agencies across the U.S. and around the world have these vans as well. We also know from widely available sources, including the U.S. government, that military drones can see through roofs and walls from ranges as high as 30,000 feet and can distinguish between adults, children, and pets, and can determine with certainty when a strike victim dies by monitoring his body temperature. Together, these facts lead us to understand that a person or persons can be remotely monitored for movement and body temperature on a street or inside a home, apartment, or hotel room, anywhere in the world by an authoritarian agent. In 1975, 41 years ago, during the Senate's Church Committee hearing on illegal intelligence gathering by the U.S. government, it was admitted that the CIA used a drug to induce heart attacks as a form of assassination. These senators on the church committee actually passed around a gun that fired a dart used to deliver a drug that caused a heart attack. Photographs have been widely circulated showing Senators Frank Church, John Tower, and Barry Goldwater holding and examining such a dart gun. It has since been alleged that the CIA, in conjunction with the U.S. Army, have isolated and weaponized viruses that are more dependable and harder to trace than the drugs they previously used. Again, alleged, not proven. But whistleblowers have come forward and admitted their involvement in the development of such viruses. Since the CIA admitted 41 years ago that they had a drug that could accomplish this task, I think it's reasonable to assume they have improved their methods. Therefore, I can say with reasonable confidence that individuals acting on behalf of the U.S. government can and have used heart failure as a weapon, and logic dictates that their methods, tools, and technologies have been refined and improved since 1975. The active denial system is a millimeter wave source weapon, microwave, that heats the water in a human target's skin and thus causes incapacitating pain. Its stated purpose is for riot control duty with a wide beam of energy intended to influence a crowd into moving back or dispersing. Developed primarily by Raytheon, these devices are intended to cause severe pain while leaving no lasting damage, and can be deployed through obstacles such as non-metal walls. However, the device has not seen widespread use as of the date of this writing. The following information in quotes comes from the document Bioeffects of Selected Non-Lethal Weapons, Addendum to the Non-Lethal Technologies Worldwide Study, NGIC-1147-101-98, by the Department of the Army, 1998. The topic is the existence of a weapon, the active denial system named above, used for warming the skin to an uncomfortable level for crowd control purposes. The range of the weapon is stated as hundreds of meters, but the paper suggests it can be used at close range with man-portable equipment. Mechanism to produce the desired effects. This concept builds on about 40 years of experience with the heating effects of microwaves. Numerous studies have been performed on animals to identify characteristics of importance to the understanding of energy deposition in animals. As a result of the physics, the relationship between the size of the animal and the wavelength of the radio frequency energy is most important. In fact, the human exposure guidelines to radio frequency radiation are designed around knowledge of the differential absorption as a function of frequency and body size. The challenge is to minimize the time to effect while causing no permanent injury to any organ or the total body, and to optimize the equipment function. The orientation of the incident energy with respect to the orientation of the animal is also important. At this point, the topic shifts to the heating of specific internal organs rather than simply heating the skin, in doing so not for crowd control, but for some innovative use on an individual. The paper goes on. Because of the apparently safe nature of body heating using microwave techniques, a variety of innovative uses of EM energy for human applications are being explored. The non-lethal application would embody a highly sophisticated microwave assembly that can be used to project microwaves in order to provide a controlled heating of a person. This controlled heating will raise the core temperature of the individual to a predetermined level to mimic a high fever. While not inflicting deadly force, the concept of heating is straightforward. The challenge is to identify and produce the correct mix of frequencies and power levels needed to do the remote heating while not injuring the specific organs in the individual illuminated by the beam. The paper goes into the details of power settings and duration of exposure for specific results, and states that vital signs can be monitored remotely to fine-tune the exposure. It states that prolonged exposure causing temperatures above 107 degrees Fahrenheit would be lethal. It also says that this process can be used to upset the water balance of a subject being irradiated. The paper doesn't explain what it means by water balance, but when I described this to a cardiologist, he knew exactly what I was talking about. Keep reading. Because the body is inhomogeneous, certain organs are, by virtue of their size and geometry, more easily coupled with one radio frequency wavelength than another. In other words, the beam can be tuned to affect one organ while not affecting others. Additionally, the document infers that the microwave beams can penetrate walls. However, the document states that metal or metal screens would block the beam. Chapter 3, Section 1.1.03. What does all of this mean? As stated above, devices are known to exist that can monitor your movements in your house. They can observe your heart rate and your body temperature. Once you are in a verified location where it is determined you will remain for an extended period of time, a bed or a chair, a microwave beam can be used to mimic a fever in a specific organ of your body, like your liver. You would not feel this beam nor its effects. This will cause your body to react to this fever as if an actual infection has set in. Your body's immune system would respond by retaining salt and water for the fight against this perceived infection. As soon as you move out of the beam's strike zone, or as soon as the beam is turned off, the organ would return to normal temperature with no long-term damage to that organ. However, repeated exposures, perhaps only 3 to 5 sessions, would cause a person's immune system to retain water and salt on a large scale, causing swelling and sudden weight gain. However, repeated exposures, perhaps only 3 to 5 sessions, would cause a person's immune system to retain water and salt on a large scale, causing swelling and sudden weight gain in the torso of the victim. Once this process is started, it causes runaway swelling of the fat tissue in the torso, including the tissue surrounding the heart. This would result in congestive heart failure, which is exactly what the cardiologist described to me when I asked him about water balance and a localized fever in the liver. In other words, congestive heart failure could be inflicted upon an otherwise healthy victim, the result of repeated exposure to a focused microwave beam used to mimic a fever/infection in any of several internal organs. The heart, though initially undamaged, would be squeezed by the fluid buildup in the chest cavity and would not be able to perform properly, causing the well-known runaway effects of water/salt retention. The early symptoms would mimic chest congestion or possibly an asthma attack, and the unaware victim would likely think they had a chest cold or pneumonia, until the time that the heart could no longer function correctly. Then, if untreated, the heart would fail, causing death. Treatment to reverse the effects of this microwave beam prior to death would be as simple as administering diuretics to facilitate fluid removal through urination. The time frame involved from initial exposure to the weapon to death would be dictated by the health and body weight of the victim. That may be a matter of hours or days, up to several months. Using the methods outlined here, a healthy person could be remotely murdered by elements of a government without ever exposing the government agent or agents to the dangers or complications of actual contact with the victim. The death would appear to be of natural causes and would be completely untraceable, as no chemical or physical residue would remain on or in the body of the victim. The murder could be accomplished from an adjacent apartment, hotel room, rented house, or mobile van. This brings up the question, who could be a victim of such an operation? It's important to remember in considering this question what we have already established as to the nature of the government agents who would be in possession of such a weapon. We know from the documented behavior of CIA agents in using psychoactive drugs that randomly chosen people were targeted, along with at least one case in Paris, France, where a CIA agent targeted an art student due to an argument in a sidewalk cafe. More on this below. This, coupled with the knowledge that given spiffy new toys, the authoritarian has a tendency to look for opportunities to use said toys, and you have the potential of government agents killing almost anyone for almost any reason, or perhaps no reason other than the fact that they can do it and get away with it. As difficult as this concept is for a sane, peaceful person to accept, the fact is that we are not talking about the behavior of sane, peaceful people. Chapter 3, Section 1.1.04, Stanley Glickman. Stanley Glickman was a promising young painter studying art in Paris. He was not politically involved in any way and was not an activist of any kind. He was an art student in love, planning a future. Glickman encountered some well-dressed Americans in a cafe in Paris. After a discussion that resulted in a disagreement, Glickman agreed to a round of drinks as a peace offering. The man who purchased the round of drinks and served Glickman's drink to him turned out to be the notorious MK Ultra operative Sidney Gottlieb. Likely due to drugs placed in his drink, Glickman suffered intense hallucinations that resulted in his being admitted to the psychiatric ward of a hospital where he was further subjected to more hallucinogens and electroshock treatments by CIA operatives. Stanley Glickman never recovered from the experiments and was dependent on his family to take care of him until his eventual death. Stanley Glickman's crime? Sidney Gottlieb wanted a guinea pig and Stanley Glickman was in the wrong cafe at the wrong time. Why am I talking about a victim of MKUltra and the CIA's experiments when the topic was a heart attack gun? Because Stanley Glickman was tortured and murdered to satisfy the curiosity and ego of an operative of the state. And others assisted in this dreadful crime simply because they were told to do so. Stanley Glickman was tortured because people were obedient and did their jobs. This is the nature of the people who now possess weapons that can both see through walls and kill you without leaving any trace of how it was accomplished. Stanley Glickman's engagement in a conversation and his opinion ran contrary to that of a CIA agent. The CIA agent possessed a weapon and used it on Stanley Glickman for the exact same reason a SWAT team uses a MRAP to serve a court summons for a parking violation, because children will play new games when given new toys. Demented children play demented games. Given the small set of examples listed here and understanding that I could continue listing examples for thousands of pages, one must come to the conclusion that we are not struggling against people who are simply confused about freedom and rights. We are fighting evil in its pure form. We cannot play nice. We cannot expect to reason with these demented servants of the state any more than we can reason with those to whom governments of the world owe some $57 trillion, CIA World Factbook. Our logic will not reach them. Our pleas mean nothing to them. Joining them and trying to use them to do our bidding will only make us like them. It is only once you view the reality of police and government servants as being an occupation army serving their political masters that their savagery begins to make sense. Once you begin to view the political establishment as nothing but puppets serving the international money masters, the whole beast begins to make sense. The hard fact is that we have but one and only one choice. Bring this beast and its enforcers down before they turn this planet into a radioactive ash heap. Humanity is at war, but sadly, few humans realize the battlefield, the armies, or the stakes. Chapter 3, Section 1.2, The True Nature of Evil. The most dangerous enemy is the one who can convince you he doesn't exist. To this end, key members of the intelligentsia have gone to great lengths to convince educated people that there is no such thing as evil. It's an interesting philosophical exercise that can allow a thinking person to contemplate deep concepts from a morally neutral point of view and can lead to some enlightening thoughts. But it all falls apart when you find out that while you are sipping your boutique coffee, chatting with your brilliant and beautiful friends at the university, your wife was stopped on the street for a minor traffic violation. But then, the cop beat her to death while she resisted, and the cop feared for his life. All the while, your children were sitting in your automobile watching their mother die. In other words, the intelligentsia has deceived you and your philosophy stinks. The world contains evil humans who do evil deeds, and the vast majority of evil deeds are those done under the guise of authority. Second, only to convincing you that your enemy doesn't exist is convincing you that your enemy looks vastly different than he actually looks. This is a simple task, and is much easier to sell to a wider audience than just the self-appointed intellectual elite in their university halls. The mainstream clergy make an incredibly comfortable living demonizing a wide array of normal human activities, while relying on guilt and ignorance to fill their congregations with the fear of eternal punishment for things that simply can't be called evil by an honest thinking person. So if we believe the state-approved clergy, a drink of whiskey, some mutual fun with your date, using a forbidden word in a sentence, wearing the wrong clothing, listening to the wrong music, keeping the details of your life private and out of the priest's ears, or simply earning money and keeping it for yourself, are all called evil, and you are told they will push you down the highway to hell. Now let's all join that same impressive clergyman as he leads us in a Solomon prayer for God to bless the brave troops as they rape, pillage, and burn the innocent in faraway lands. And let's not forget to pray that God guides and protects our great leader and fills him with wisdom as he decides which poor village he will incinerate this week. Perhaps that clergyman misunderstood the scripture that states, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter." Before someone claims that I'm Christian bashing for calling out the corruption of clergy, let me point out some others who are guilty of using the same method of bait and switch in the definition of evil. Almost every television cop show and almost every Hollywood movie drama portrays a cartoon version of evil that is either grossly wrong or intentionally deceptive. We see time and time again lies spoon-fed to the masses that portray cartoon evil villains threatening the innocent, held at bay only by the brave men and women of law enforcement. And evil villains in dark, dirty, foreign countries threatening a peaceful world, while the only thing that keeps them from enslaving humanity are the good super spies with amazing abilities fighting for freedom, justice, and the American way. Or the brave American super snipers who never kill the innocent. This storyline is simply a rehashing of the great man / boogeyman myth, dressed up in a fancy wrapper and sold to yet another generation. If Joseph Goebbels could see modern media, he would be both proud and pleased. To understand evil, you have to dissect authoritarians into three codependent and equally guilty groups. First, the powerful, then the powerful enthralled, and finally, the obedient. First, let's look at the powerful. They are the easy ones to pick on. They are the top-tier leaders, the elite central bankers, the upper crust of the corporate world, the highest-ranking intelligence officers, the highest-ranking military officers, and finally, the least powerful of the top tier, the political heads of state. These are the untouchables. With a few exceptions, these are positions that are handed down to the select, not earned by the deserving. These truly powerful people will do anything to anyone, including each other, to remain in power. They form and break alliances, and as they do, people in the lower ranks die, sometimes in quite large numbers. The one starkly striking thing about these elites is that they, for the most part, apparently believe the entire great man myth and view themselves as a kind of super race destined to guide humanity. Like something out of Mein Kampf or some 1920s eugenics handbook, most of them believe in the hereditary right of ascension, and they practice it. That fact may be hard to believe, especially for Americans who have little or no respect for kings and royal families. But no matter what you or I think, the important thing is that they believe and practice hereditary right of ascension with violent vigor and enthusiasm. And in doing so, they justify any and all actions that they must take to maintain their power. They believe it is their responsibility, their destiny, and their divinely appointed burden to be in power, and they will incinerate millions without hesitation to fulfill that divine appointment. Individually, they are not Hollywood movie monsters. They are kind to their pets, and they love their mothers. They enjoy art and music and don't ever want to see another ugly war. They give incredible amounts of their wealth to charities, and yet so long as they breathe, they will maintain their power structure. if it means burning their own houses to the ground. This is Acton's axiom. Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, displayed in its fullness. Next, let us consider the power enthralled and the other side of Acton's axiom. Buppert's corollary, power attracts the corruptible. Those who want to dominate and are drawn to power are almost always enthralled with those who have power. These are typically the fiercely loyal fanatics, not to a cause, nation, or team, but their loyalty is to powerful individuals, and ultimately, their loyalty is to their quest for their own power. On the outer surface, these people tend to appear more obviously evil, as their names are often associated with the kinds of crimes of the state that make the headlines and lead the news cycles. But like almost all criminals, they rarely consider themselves or their actions as evil. They have layers of mental hoops they jump through to justify their actions. They use collectivist excuses to justify killing the innocent or destroying economies, and they almost always believe what they are doing is for the greater good. And as a final level of faith in the state, they believe the double-edged excuse. If the overall action really is bad, their boss is to blame. But if the execution of the action is the part that is bad, their underlings should have refused the order. By writing in the magic middle, they justify their evil by blaming the decision on those above them while blaming the action on those below them. These disgusting humans are incredibly dangerous. Finally, we come to the obedient, the patriotic, the ones bursting with natural or cultural pride, or painted over in civic duty and esprit de corps. Although all categories of humans tend to have overlapping groups, and it's almost never accurate to draw hard lines between people, you should strive to differentiate between the obedient, as described here, and the neutrals, described later in this manual. Neutrals typically are not successful in dirty jobs like killing, caging, destroying, extorting, and intimidating, because their own set of morals cause them to object to such behavior. In cases where neutrals are forced to commit atrocities due to circumstances, they usually suffer mentally and emotionally, as they lack the coping mechanisms that the more obedient utilize. And that may be the easiest way to judge between neutrals and the obedient, as the more obedient seem to be well suited taking orders and committing atrocities. Some even relish in the deed, but even then, they find ways of excusing their actions. However, once again, these are not cartoon monsters. They have families. They walk their dog. They get stuck in traffic. They have more debt than they want. They are very often church supporters. They may think cat videos are cute, but given the order, they will kick in your door, kill your dog, and place a gun to your grandmother's head. Then, when they have justified what they have done in their duty report, they will congratulate themselves for being a hero and go home to their children. These very human, seemingly normal, everyday people are our enemies. The powerful will incinerate cities to maintain their power. Those enthralled with the powerful will justify that decision and pass the order to the obedient, who will not only obey, but they will gleefully commit mass murder and brag about it in their old age. The most immediately dangerous individuals of the three groups are the obedient. But you can't win by fighting them because there is an endless supply of the obedient. You have to fight smart and not based on the emotions of the moment. Remember, Henry Kissinger referred to the obedient as dumb, stupid animals to be used as pawns. Hedonis referred to the obedient as the immortals because as soon as one died, there was another fool waiting to step in and take his place. So again, as much as it seems that the obedient should be our targets, and as much justified hate will be rightly aimed at the obedient in the coming years, we have to look beyond wasting resources and time attempting to engage the obedient directly and find ways to touch the power enthralled and eventually the untouchables. By doing so, we break the chain of command, freeing the obedient so that they may choose to stop obeying. Chapter 3, Section 2, Know Yourself. The wise man lives by principles and is never in a hurry to make a bad decision. The fool only knows his immediate desire and rushes towards his next mistake. Oftentimes, the desire to do something overrides the ability to use wisdom in discriminating between what can be done and what should be done, as opposed to what should never be done. Generally, things like anger, fear, desperation, and ignorance are amplified by would-be leaders who have something directly to gain by your foolish choices. One way to spot such a would-be leader is to ask yourself what they have to gain if you follow their lead. What is the real product they're selling? Are they selling a path, a concept, an idea, or are they selling themselves as the guru of that path, concept, idea? Are they teaching their followers how to lead themselves, stand on their own, and go out there and do the right things? Or are they building a dependent following to constantly fluff the leader's ego while he siphons the wealth of the followers? It really doesn't do any good to commit yourself to oppose the state only to sell yourself into the emotional or financial servitude of some guru, liberty cheerleader, or other would-be great man. Rather, examine yourself and ask yourself why you feel the need to follow. Be brutally honest and keep in mind that back in the day, the followers of Jim Jones made every possible excuse to continue believing. It's still that way with the adherents of L. Ron Hubbard, and he's been dead for 30 years. But just because your favorite liberty hero isn't the one calling for believers to follow him into the desert to form a libertarian commune where everyone lives in shipping containers howling with the coyotes at night, that doesn't mean you need to sit on the edge of your seat waiting for your hero's next podcast or video. So again, be honest with yourself. Are you being led towards independence, self-reliance, and wise decision-making, or are you just being led? Self-examination is one important key to learning wisdom. Asking yourself about your motives and your desires and honestly comparing them to tested principles like non-aggression and self-defense is critical in self-development. Thinking in terms of the long approach, rather than focusing on the short-term wants, is an exercise in self-control and self-discipline, both critical in the development of wisdom. Teaching yourself to look beyond a sales pitch is an even more advanced key to wisdom that will never stop paying for itself. And finally, the constant reevaluation of your plans, your actions, and your direction is the only way to stay on target to get to your goal. This is true for the individual, and it's true for a group of like-minded individuals seeking a common goal. Otherwise, the naturally more flamboyant personalities will inadvertently become the flawed leaders, and the cause will be lost for yet another generation.
Chapter 3, Section 2.1, The Four Conventional Strategies. One of the most common complaints against supporters of freedom, and more specifically the libertarian-type activists, is the fact that they can't seem to accomplish any significant progress towards a free society. Actually, they don't seem to have any kind of clear step-by-step process to achieve a free society, and the ones who claim to have such a strategy can't seem to explain the mechanism that would allow their system to actually come into existence. So here, I will examine the four standard strategies commonly espoused for obtaining a free society. I view the first two strategies to be foolish and counterproductive at best. The third strategy I believe to be necessary, however only useful in hindsight each time the state fails to do what it claims exclusive right to do. Therefore, I don't view the third strategy as a strategy to assist the failure of the state, but more as a propaganda campaign for freedom. And the fourth strategy I view as the most critical of the four, and yet by itself it is incomplete. As I cover these four strategies, the reader may notice his or her feelings being pricked, as almost all of us have at some time used some of these failed strategies. I would urge the reader to press on, look for logic in the argument, and set aside feelings of loyalty and dedication to leaders and processes that have simply not produced what they have advertised. Don't allow yourself to be caught up in a kind of gambler's fallacy where you convince yourself to keep hitting the same spot over and over either because a win is due or because having invested so much in your spot you can't afford to change at this point in the game. Rather, see that the wisest move in a rigged game is to stop playing. Chapter 3, Section 2.1.01. Strategy 1, The Political Means. Vote for Joe. Support this law. Repeal this law. Vote for me. I'm better than Joe, and I'll support this law while I repeal that law. Sign this petition so the government will do what we say. We'll win a majority, then we'll use democracy to force the world to be free. Without exception, every anarchist should already know that there are two fundamentally opposed means whereby a person can achieve their desires and their sustenance. These are work and robbery. There simply is no third choice. When you work to produce something, or when you peacefully persuade someone to trade for something that has been produced through work, you're using the economic means to satisfy your desires and needs. The opposite of this is the political means, or robbery, where you use fraud, theft, violence, or threats of violence to satisfy your desires and needs. On the surface, there would seem to be a third means of satisfying your desires and needs, that being either charity or lottery. However, upon closer examination, charity lottery is simply a subset of either the economic means, where the charity lottery is voluntary and is a direct result of the abundance produced by the economic means, or it's a subset of the political means, where robbery is justified by giving a portion into the charity lottery, usually for a political advantage of some kind. This fundamental truth, that all desires are fulfilled from either the economic means or the political means, is the cornerstone of ethical anarchism. If you intend to establish a free society, no longer bound by the evils of government, theft, coercion, and violence, what kind of fool would you have to be to assume the path to obtain such a society could be found in utilizing government theft, coercion, and violence as your means? In addition to the blatant absurdity of using theft, coercion, and violence to stop theft, coercion, and violence, a thinking person should ask this simple question. Why continue to do something that, in the last 10,000 years, has never worked? That said, the direct political means, however immoral, provides something the other three methods lack. That is a theoretical mechanism to kill the state. Theoretically, some saintly, incredibly wealthy, and brilliant human could take over all the governments of the world, crush the international banking cartels, dissolve the government connection to corporations and the military-industrial complex, free the media to publish the truth, and break government bonds with the clergy and all education systems, and then choose to release humanity from the state by dissolving the whole system. And if you believe that is actually possible, you likely believe in unicorns, elves, the Easter Bunny, and candy that falls from rainbows. Yet, that is a more likely scenario than the ones most believers in statism place their undying faith. An argument can be made that an activist involved in a political campaign, voting, petition circulation, lobbying, or some other political activity, can be doing that activity for the purpose of gaining the attention of the public or making a statement. The argument being that the political means can be an educational opportunity, not an attempt to change government. Oftentimes, the activist who runs for office will privately say that they have no intention of winning or that they are secretly an anarchist. Oddly enough, they rarely say that publicly. In other words, their campaign is usually based on lies and deception. That's why I find this whole line of reason a weak argument at best. From a practical point, I view this like feeding a slot machine coins because it may be possible to strike it rich. Ignore the incredible cost and the almost guaranteed negative return on investment, and ignore the unstable grasp on reality one has to embrace to believe such fantasies, and ask yourself if you are being honest with yourself about your motives. If you are really campaigning for office to educate the public, are you sure you would follow through by refusing office if you were elected? And what about all that money that flows into political campaigns? Do activists who run for office to make a statement ever do so on their own dime, or do they rake in donations from the gullible? When the politician makes their pleas for donations, do they make it clear that this is just a publicity stunt and they have no intention of winning? If not, isn't their campaign based on deception? Politics is aggression inflicted upon society, the strong upon the weak. It has been fairly compared to rape. Can you justify attempting to rape a victim for educational purposes if you promise to pull away at the moment of penetration? I can imagine no argument that would morally allow me to call myself an anarchist while using the political means to achieve my desires. I can imagine no argument that would morally justify deceiving people into giving me their hard-earned money for a political campaign that I knew I had no chance of winning. Secession is often trumpeted as a path to freedom, most prominently by the same people who supported and profited nicely from a longtime member of the U.S. Congress, Ron Paul, running as a major presidential candidate in 2008 and 2012, bagging some $75 million in contributions just to the official Ron Paul campaign coffers, not including income earned by a dozen websites that promoted his campaign, plus all the books, shirts, hats, stickers, and all other paraphernalia sold. All that aside, secession falls squarely under the heading of the political means, as it is always dependent upon individuals and government acting to permit said secession. Secession is accomplished using one of, or a combination of, two activities. Either by petitioning a government for permission to secede, or through armed conflict to force secession within a geographic boundary. Armed conflict for the purpose of secession usually turns into revolution, and no revolution has ever produced a free people. Revolution is a violent, bloody process that, if successful, exchanges the old tyrant for a new one, then forces that new government on people whether they want it or not. Petitioning the government, whether by voting or any other process, is the act of using government to achieve your desires, again, the political means. And once again, it has never produced a free people. Also, every secession movement to date has had, as an aspect of its purpose, a set of geographic borders to divide those people within the new governing body from those in the old governed territory to be enforced upon people on both sides of that borderline by violence whether or not they wanted that border. That is the direct opposite of freedom. The truth of the matter is, if you scratch a secessionist, you get minarchist blood. Their true goal is a tiny local watchman government. Embrace secession and minarchism and ignore all historical examples of tiny watchman governments morphing into death camps owned by an empire or becoming the lapdog of that empire. Believing in secession as a path to freedom is literally a non sequitur. One simply does not lead to the other. There is no mechanism connecting the two. Secession is a simple exchange of a faraway master enforced locally to a local master. The proponents of secession often resort to slogans and mantras about anarchy being the ultimate secession of the individual. But again, their ranting lacks a mechanism to explain why a government of any size would ever allow secession down to the individual level. Secession is much like alchemy. It seems to make sense, requires lots of faith and an element of magic, and will never produce what it advertises, yet its believers fanatically cling to it in spite of all evidence and logic. Why then do leaders of the movement still push the political means as a viable strategy to achieve a free society? I don't know the definitive answer, but considering that a conservative estimate of the overall profitability of the Ron Paul campaign tops $100 million and ended with his son embedded in the U.S. Senate, I suspect the answer is not that hard to imagine. But here's a different question. Is there nothing that could have been done with those millions of dollars that would have been a better investment to liberty than handing it to a politician and his little factory of cronyism and nepotism? Chapter 3, Section 2.1.02, Strategy 2, Civil Disobedience. In my whole life, no other topic has caused more people to be angry at me than when I've explained the accepted legal definition of civil disobedience. The reason for such anger is that so many people have invested so much of themselves, including life, liberty, and property, in support of civil disobedience. Then when they hear the cold, hard facts, not washed through a poem by Henry David Thoreau, but the actual truth, they simply refuse to face the fact that they are not doing what they think they're doing when they commit civil disobedience. So rather than accept the truth, they take their frustrations out on me, the messenger. Fortunately for you, dear reader, I don't don't care how many angry libertarians and anarchists want to spew hate at me for popping their magic bubble. My only responsibility is to speak truth. Therefore, once again, I enter the breach. Civil disobedience is not an act of revolution, rebellion, nor anarchism. Civil disobedience is an intentional, usually peaceful, breaking of a law to demonstrate resistance, not to government itself, but resistance to that specific law while remaining obedient to the overall concept of government law. As such, most modern governments recognize civil disobedience as a rightful method to redress a specific grievance. Oftentimes in court cases, the civil disobedient does not face the same punishment as someone who normally would break the same law. So keep in mind, no matter the intent of the activist, civil disobedience is considered in the same category as voting, petitioning, sending letters to politicians, and marching in a protest. You may point out one or two specific cases where a person used civil disobedience and a court reacted with an extreme sentence or punishment. To this, I would answer, of course this happens. You didn't think government thugs would obey their own laws and procedures, did you? They do what they want to do. Government justice is often dictated by the whim of a government judge who is lenient when he feels good and harsh when he feels bad. This is the one glaring reason that civil disobedience is almost always the most foolhardy choice a person can make when considering the question of how to influence government. And really, that is the key phrase. You're trying to influence government to behave in the way you want it to behave. In other words, you are back to using the political means to achieve your desires. An argument can be made that an activist involved in civil disobedience may be doing that activity for the purpose of gaining the attention of the public. The argument being that civil disobedience can be an educational opportunity, not an attempt to change government. This is a legitimate argument, but let's be honest with our terminology. If you argue that what you're doing, although it may appear to look like civil disobedience, is actually an attempt at getting attention, then let's call it what it is. It's not civil disobedience. It is a publicity stunt. Why deceive? Why not just be honest from the start? Why not admit you are poking the lion so that if the lion wakes up and tears you limb from limb, you'll have a great video for your social media page and you'll get more attention? This seems childish to me, but it can be considered educational. Of course, you may end up with your brain splattered across a sidewalk by an angry cop, but that will definitely go viral on the internet. In short, I would advise an anarchist to consider the possible cost of putting yourself at the mercy of a government goon and ask yourself if it is worth that price for the hope that a government may change slightly or perhaps your hit count on social media may increase. Again, I'm not condemning such stunts. I'm simply urging wisdom and maybe some good old-fashioned cost-benefit analysis to compare the risk to some other action that doesn't involve the possibility of death by cop. That said, no act or series of acts of civil disobedience have ever produced a free society. A slight temporary reprieve in tyranny can sometimes be achieved, usually at great cost. But like secession, there is no mechanism in civil disobedience that would cause a government to shut down and vanish. For whatever civil disobedience is or isn't, we can be assured it is not a useful strategy for obtaining a free society. Chapter 3, Section 2.1.03. Strategy 3, Speaking Truth for Posterity. The phrase, speak truth to power, is an old Quaker phrase that has been co-opted by several groups for different purposes. Although it didn't make it into print until the 20th century, its origin is commonly believed to be a 19th century description of an event in 1655 when Quaker activist George Fox was captured and brought before Oliver Cromwell. Facing the threat of death by flames or worse, Fox proclaimed without fear or respect of person the truth as he knew it to be. Cromwell, a Puritan and a sworn enemy of the Quakers, was so impressed by this man of faith that he let Fox go free. Twice. Subsequently, the story has become perverted to purvey the idea that Fox spoke truth to power to influence government to do his bidding. Balderdash! Fox had exactly zero influence on the Cromwell government. George Fox almost certainly believed himself to be a dead man, talking as he rebuked, condemned, and reviled the murderer Cromwell. The fact that Cromwell's conscience struck him and caused him to act in mercy towards Fox speaks to Cromwell's Christian upbringing and parentage, and not to the absurd idea that facing death, Fox tried to use the government that he so reviled. The witness of George Fox's life proclaims that any words he spoke to Cromwell were spoken with a full knowledge that he was speaking to the ages, not to some usurper on a man-made throne of blood and gore. Thus, we have the key. We must boldly speak truth in the face of power, not to influence power, but to state truth for posterity's sake. Ludwig Heinrich Edler von Mises said, "Do not give in to evil, but proceed ever more boldly against it." Mises could have easily taken the path of Milton Friedman and sold himself into the service of the powers that be. But like Fox, Mises was not that kind of man. Mises boldly spoke truth in the face of power in Austria as a fascist Nazi shadow descended upon Europe. And then he came to America and continued to speak truth even as soft fascism continued to descend upon the earth by way of the fist of Washington, D.C. And so we should learn this lesson. Speak truth, not to influence the war-mongering, hate-filled, violent mob called government, but speak to posterity. Speak as if your children and their children are watching and listening to every word you utter. Therefore, we speak truth for posterity, not to change government, and not to bring about a free society, and not to convince the naysayers. We speak truth to posterity for the sake of posterity. One fast note about filming police, and then I'll cover this topic more thoroughly later. Filming the police falls under this category of speaking truth if done properly. If you as an activist are filming police so that police will be more accountable or so agencies will hold police more accountable, you are not a friend of freedom. You are a statist. Stop reading this book, go lick the boot of your master, and leave the activism to those of us who know who our enemy is. If, on the other hand, you understand that police are nothing but violent enforcers for their state masters, and their only real job is to kill, maim, cage, and destroy for the purpose of intimidating the general public, then we are on common ground. Eventually, governments on all levels will outlaw the filming of police. Again, more on this later. But before that time comes, documenting the activities of police is a critical aspect of speaking truth for posterity. The only way we can justify the irregular warfare that is about to erupt is if we have thoroughly documented the brutality of police. The only way the rest of the world can know the oppression you face in your neighborhood and in your town is if we film not only police, but every oppressive action of the state everywhere it happens. Filming, recording, exposing, and documenting everything we can document is an act of speaking truth for posterity. This is true in the Americas, in Europe, in Asia, and everywhere governments use their enforcement boot to choke humanity, but it is also true in the neighborhoods and villages of Pakistan, Yemen, and other places where governments rain death upon the innocent for the sheer purpose of causing terror and hate, while filthy politicians in the West strut around claiming they are bombing for peace. In the future, our generation will be judged based on how we, as individuals, respond to the vile actions of governments around the world as they murder and maim the innocent in the name of peace. Chapter 3, Section 2.1.04, Strategy for Agorism. Buckminster Fuller famously said, "You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete." This foundational wisdom is why one person setting up a Bitcoin wallet and using it is a more effective means of fighting tyranny than all the end the Fed websites, books, t-shirts, rallies, and petitions combined. On the other hand, several breakthrough designs that Fuller invested in never caught on in the marketplace because they were crushed by giant government-backed corporations who were deeply invested in the old model. So as much as I love the genius of Bucky, and as much as I love the innovation of the blockchain, it is simply one wheel on the cart. By itself, it will go nowhere. For Buckminster Fuller's philosophy to actually work, someone must break the violent monopoly stranglehold the state maintains on the market. Despite all of Buckminster Fuller's genius, he never understood that corporations like General Motors, along with the U.S. federal government, would just slap down his new model and continue selling the old model. This is the current situation with blockchain technology and Bitcoin. As revolutionary and inventive as it is, and as valuable as it is in our struggle, by itself it will not produce a free society. It is simply one tool. I should clarify what I mean by agorism. Sam Konkin said, "The goal of agorism is the agora, the society of the open marketplace as near to untainted by theft, assault, and fraud as can be humanly attained is as close to a free society as can be achieved. And a free society is the only one in which each and every one of us can satisfy his or her subjective values without crushing others' values by violence and coercion." I like that definition. I would add to that, agorism is counter-economics in action. Although black markets are part of the agora, agorism doesn't have to involve black markets. Growing your own veggies, repairing your neighbor's roof in exchange for a motorcycle, or riding that motorcycle without license or registration are all acts of agorism. Driving to Florida, buying a load of oranges from a farmer for cash, taking those oranges to Cincinnati and selling them by a freeway off-ramp without a permit is agorism. Running a private loan business without permits or permission from government is agorism. I have long been a supporter and practitioner of agorism. It's not easy and you probably won't get rich, but there is a kind of satisfaction knowing you're outside of the state system. Full-on agorism has its dangerous side. Every bowman in the woods who refuses to support Prince John runs the risk of being kidnapped by the sheriff. And any time you find yourself in the hands of the state, your situation becomes precarious. State justice involves half-witted buffoons with badges enforcing the random edicts of crony politicians, interpreted by judges who are typically failed attorneys lacking the energy, ability, or intelligence to live without the teat of government planted firmly in their mouth. So none of those people can be depended upon to act like predictable, civilized humans. Since the vast majority of agorism requires some kind of permanent base of operation, a farm, a compound, a storefront, or even a website, you become a stationary target for the Sheriff of Nottingham to come snorting around looking for a cut of your business. For this reason, agorism requires wisdom and an ongoing balancing act to teeter between full-on fiscal independence and just doing enough to support the agora without landing in a cage. Agorism is not the end-all be-all that some would have you believe, but it is a necessary step in the right direction. By itself, it will never, as Konkin had hoped, starve nor bleed the beast in any significant way. If our numbers somehow grew to the point that the state were ever seriously endangered by agorists, government agents would simply label us terrorists, demonize us in the mainstream media, round us up, and cage or kill us. Instead, agorists can play the game wisely. You don't want your children indoctrinated by the state, so don't send them to government schools. You don't want to feed your family fluoride-infused food and drinks, so learn how to filter your water, avoid mass-produced food and drinks, and eat healthy. You don't want to serve the Federal Reserve or the international banking cartels, so use cryptocurrencies as much as possible and save yourself the cost of outrageous fees in the process. Approaching agorism with this mindset allows us to embrace the counter-economy without deifying a process. A sort of odd subset of agorism is a notion that peaceful parenting will descend upon a generation and bring salvation from our blessed mothers. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying we should beat children. I'm only saying that, again, deifying a process won't bring a libertarian Garden of Eden. Please keep in mind, peaceful parenting is not new, is not a product of libertarian thought, and like other pie-in-the-sky fantasies, provides no actual mechanism of how it will end the state. Peaceful parenting libertarians will never reproduce at a rate so significant that their little angelic wonder children will have any kind of numerical advantage in a world of billions of statist children. Also, in spite of what a certain mind-controlling Canadian salesman purports, peaceful parenting doesn't guarantee peaceful children. I am the father of three peaceful adult anarchist children, and I can tell you there are many factors involved in raising children. My father was raised in the hill country of Appalachia during the 1920s and the 1930s, and was never struck by an adult during his entire childhood. It didn't magically make him a libertarian anarchist any more than my mother was, and she was raised in a violent home where whipping children with a switch was a daily occurrence. By the way, she was one of 12 children, so I will not judge the morality of her parents for using corporal punishment, having never lived in a house with 12 rug monkeys swinging from the drapes. I will only say that as an aspect of agorism, child raising can only take us so far, and then we have to rely on something else to actually kill the state. Otherwise, we hand our peaceful children a world of violence for them to deal with. The oldest and most time-tested version of agorism is escapism. From monks in mountaintop hideaways to prophets leading followers into the desert, escapism is a go-to immediate but temporary solution to state oppression. Escapism is usually the choice writing mechanism used by libertarian and anarchist fantasy and science fiction authors because it's both an easy story to write and to sell. Typically, escapism involves some dynamic personality that the followers rally around, almost always a man with an angelic vision and a huge personality, and a fitting ego. In most cases, this version of agorism ends in one of two ways. Either the movement involved gradually becomes irrelevant, or someone in the established state structure notices them and government service descend upon the outpost where murder and or suicide end the rebels and cultists. Classic examples of the latter group include the mountain fortress of Masada, where some 960 Jewish Sicarii unsuccessfully attempted to evade the Romans, or in modern times, the Jonestown, Guyana massacre, the unfortunate folks at Ruby Ridge, Idaho, and the Seventh-day Adventists at Waco, Texas, who all followed the same escapism to their bloody demise. Needless to say, these methods have been proven to fail miserably at ending the state. The very best methods this movement ever produces is a small isolated group that will eventually vanish through attrition, or the group becomes disenchanted with the dynamic leader and they abandon him to his creeping insanity. The other less common outcome can be seen in the 1800s Mormon anti-government, anti-establishment migration to Utah, where the radicalism was gradually replaced by mainstream political leaders. Now, after only 150 years, we see Utah as a seat of the NSA spy network, and the CIA has found Utah Mormons to be ripe for recruiting into its murderous enterprise. In today's world, we can watch New Hampshire's free state radicalism quickly being replaced by more level heads. So looking ahead into the future of the free state, we already see Orwell's Animal Farm working itself out as it did in Utah. Sorry, Snowball, but you and your little radio show are out. The one thing we never ever see from escapism is even the slightest possibility of ending or even weakening the state, but that fact rarely affects the wide-eyed faithful as they follow their great man into the wilderness. Chapter 3, Section 2.2. The Need for a New Strategy. To put it simply, the state is a problem. Fortunately, humans are innovative creatures. We are not just tool makers, as the anthropologists like to call us. After all, lots of animals use tools and some animals make their tools. Rather, we are problem solvers. For humans, tools are not just a way to crack a nut. Tools are a step in the process of problem solving. The human doesn't just find or make a tool for a job. The human keeps the tool and uses it or modifies it to fit whatever problem needs to be solved. Once the human masters a tool, the human will look for other tasks to use the same tool on. So the basket that was created to carry berries becomes a bucket to carry water and a bowl to mix the berries with the water. Another aspect of human nature is our fascination with watching other humans solve problems. For lack of a better word, we are voyeuristic. Not only in our reproductive habits, but in our tendency to take pleasure in watching others confronting challenges and seeing others overcome those challenges. This is why we enjoy stories, novels, and movies, and other forms of entertainment that tell the story of someone overcoming a problem. It's also the reason people like to watch game shows and reality shows on television. An aspect of this deeply human tendency is to copy or mimic the methods of problem solving that we observe other humans successfully utilizing. In spite of what authoritarians want to teach our children, copying is not cheating. Without the human urge to copy, we would still be naked, sitting under a bush in the Kalahari, eating bugs. But we are not naked eating bugs because humans naturally copy from each other. We make and modify tools and we solve problems. Actually, humans not only excel at problem solving, we thrive on it. The vast majority of games that people play are simply exercises in problem solving, and humans love games. So we should think of the state as nothing more than a problem. A very serious problem, but just a problem. And, I might add, the state is not necessarily the biggest problem humans have overcome. It's only the current problem. Remember, while other megafauna around us were experiencing mass extinction during and directly after the last ice age that happened in conjunction with radical climate upheavals, humans thrived and even experienced a sort of population explosion. Keeping the problem in perspective, we must reject the myth that the tools commonly used are the only tools that can be used. Since using the political means is both unethical and counterproductive, and since civil disobedience is nothing more than a publicity stunt at best and always involves unnecessary risk, and since speaking truth for posterity is great but does little if anything to advance our cause in the present tense, and agorism, although critically important, cannot achieve our goals on its own, we must have a fifth strategy if we are to succeed. So then, since our problem is the state, and to defeat it, we must break the power of governments, corporations, banking cartels, the media, the intelligentsia, and the clergy, why not copy from an entity who has taken this process to an art form? No one is as good at eliminating competition as the state itself. No one has more experience at killing governments, corrupting the media, discrediting the clergy, and baffling the intelligentsia than the state. No one is better at destroying a currency than the state. If we examine how the state kills competition, what tools the state uses to destroy governments, and how the state manipulates the storyline to always favor a pro-state agenda, then we can copy the methods of our enemy and turn them on him. We have but two limitations. We must do this task while keeping our actions within the zero aggression principle. And we must avoid the trap of central planning and leader dependency. That may be tricky, but it is not impossible for the species that figured out how to thrive during mass extinctions and ice ages. So what lessons can we learn from our enemy, the state, that we can use to kill governments, corrupt the media, discredit the clergy, and baffle the intelligentsia? During the 1940s, the major governments of the world were engrossed in a war that touched almost everyone alive at the time. The obvious aspects of the Second World War involved massive troop movements, the incineration of cities and people living in them, incredible destruction, the rounding up and murdering of populations, and stark hunger for millions who were robbed to pay for it all. Everyone knows at least something about that war. What is less known about that time is that even when warplanes stopped filling the skies and tanks stopped rumbling across the earth, there continued to be unseen armies engaging in sedition, subversion, sabotage, and irregular warfare. Not uniformed armies marching in lines, taking orders and throwing grenades, but workers, fouling machines, nurses passing secret messages, radio broadcasters spreading propaganda, and riflemen selectively disposing of high-value targets. So three governments were famously defeated in the wars of the 1940s. But in the decades that followed, dozens of governments were toppled, religions were perverted, cultures were crushed, and powerful corporations were brought to their knees. Was this done by activists chalking the sidewalk in front of police stations, video blogging about the Federal Reserve, or following some liberty cheerleader to his private Galt's Gulch in the desert? No. The CIA, the MI6, KGB, and Mossad did it with some of the tools in this book. If I do my job, I will show you the raw tools that should inspire you to develop the new strategy while respecting private property and the rights of the innocent, and doing so without central planning and without a great man.
Chapter 4. The Three-Part Attack. Imagine a scorpion. It has two independent claws configured opposite of each other, used to agitate, distract, injure, and subdue its opponents. Of a very different design, the scorpion has a third weapon, a long tail with a deadly venomous stinger that it uses only at the right moment for the purpose of delivering a paralyzing and debilitating blow. The two claws almost compete in the same area, badgering its enemy from opposite sides. The moments the claws have the complete attention of the enemy, the stinger comes in fast and delivers the deadly, accurate injection, ending the struggle. The scorpion gives us a battle plan to emulate. We need to have the above-ground anarchist network on the one side represented by one claw, and we need the underground sabotage network on the other side represented by a separate claw. Then, seemingly unrelated to either, is the stinger with its irregular warfare, always present, patiently waiting for the right moment to strike a selective blow. Consider the scorpion as more than a three-part killing machine. The adult scorpion, an arachnid related to spiders, will have as many as 12 eyes, 10 of which may operate independently, and in addition to its actual eyes, it may have areas of its body that are not considered eyes, but still detect light and motion. So you could say the scorpion has a variety of viewpoints, all processing different types of information. The scorpion lacks the kind of central nervous system that humans have, so it is nothing like the decision-making brain we see in mammals. Rather, it has a series of nerve bundles attached to specific muscles and organs, sending multiple impulses independent of the other muscles and organs. So, for example, one or more eyes may send messages to a pincer directing its motions and actions in a fight, without input from other eyes that may be sending messages to the other pincher directing it independently during the same fight. This direct connection between its pincers and its eyes can communicate messages much faster than in mammals, where all messages have to travel to the brain for decision-making and central planning of all actions. In a very real sense, the scorpion possesses a decentralized and even to a certain extent, a distributed decision-making system, making it far more of an effective fighter than a mammal of equal size limited by central planning. Considering the example of the scorpion, it is my intent in this writing to bring together lessons learned from 150 years of anarchist writings, established military strategy, and balanced wisdom in order to guide a very disjointed, disorganized, and confused movement to become a more focused cause for freedom. It has been said, "When I was a child, I thought as a child, I spoke as a child, and I acted like a child. But a time came in my life when I was no longer a child, and it became prudent for me to put away childish things." That old saying is not a condemnation of childhood. It is an admonition to be the grown-up that we are. The wise remember the foolishness of their childhood and grow from it. At some point, key anarchists will see the need for their movement to mature and put away childish behavior. They will understand that they must stop continuously embracing stunts formulated by children vying for attention. When that time comes, an operational field manual such as this one will come in handy. That's not to say this manual is perfect nor exhaustive. It is simply a step towards leaving behind childish thinking and childish beliefs, and embracing the hard, honest facts of adulthood. Santa Claus, or insert your favorite great man here, will not magically appear to bring you gifts like secession, a night watchman government, a gold standard with full banking reserve, or a miraculous redistribution of wealth for all the happy workers of the world. Fantasies and dreams of sugar plums, no matter how carefully formed, will not set you free from the deeply evil men who profit from the state. Waving signs that say, "End the Fed," will not somehow inspire the men to whom governments of the world owe some $57 trillion to suddenly play fair. The men who control and profit from the current system will not one day realize the people of the world don't want to be their slaves and just close up their banking cartels and slip off into the good night on their yachts. The hard reality is, as history has displayed for us far too often, those with power will murder on an unimaginable scale to maintain and expand their monopoly of power. Now that those powers that be control nuclear arsenals and have proven the propensity to use them on civilian populations, it is childish beyond belief to expect humans will ever achieve freedom while those men of power live. When you add into the equation the fact that these powerful men possess underground bunker systems, including long-term seed storage, and they have openly published their desire to control or drastically reduce the human population, why would any clear-thinking adult entertain the notion that simply winning an election, or drafting a new constitution, or passing a law, or repealing a law, or demanding governments behave, will stop these monsters or the beasts they serve? And it is nothing but sheer cowardice to accept some slight pacification of one kind or another while passing the slavery on to your children and grandchildren. In fact, the over 250 million humans murdered by their own governments during the last century, that number does not include wars, could not have happened had our grandfathers and their grandfathers stood up and killed the state rather than what they did, which was to take the same path used today by the current liberty movement and all those who attempt to make the state kinder, gentler, and more palatable to the masses. I stated earlier that I respect pacifists, and I stand by that. However, I don't agree with their philosophy. I do recognize that there exists a consistency in the philosophy of many pacifists, for example, Jainism, and a very few Christians seem very consistent. But in most pacifists that I have encountered, there are glaring inconsistencies. Unfortunately, pacifism of the glaringly inconsistent type has deeply influenced many of the more famous liberty personalities. Of all people, students of libertarianism should understand the relationship between rights and responsibilities. For example, I have a right to my property, including my life, so long as I respect the same right of property in others. However, if I fail to respect the property rights of another person, I relinquish the equal right of my property. Libertarians usually understand this and recognize it as the basis of the morality of self-defense. So if someone attempts to murder me, thereby attempting to destroy the property of my life, I can rightfully destroy the property of their life because they relinquished their right of that property when they attempted aggression upon me. Again, most people understand this naturally, even if they never thought out its philosophical basis. Where many people have fallen down is in their own responsibility to maintain their rights, and I believe this is where many libertarians have become confused by their exposure to inconsistent pacifists. The libertarians I am referring to here theoretically agree that self-defense is morally acceptable, and most do not call themselves pacifists. But they fail to arm themselves in any real manner, and if they were forced to defend themselves, they would have no idea how to do so. What they fail to realize is that there exists an inherent responsibility to self-defense that works hand in hand with their right of property. Inconsistent pacifists and waves of propaganda from the state have systematically taught people to expect protection to come from some outside authority or entity, rather than the individual being responsible for their own security. This is what I was referring to when I said that, had our forefathers responded correctly to the advance of the state, the 20th century would not have been a century marked by constant war and genocide. That does not excuse those acting on behalf of the state in the murders of hundreds of millions of people. It only means that there was a responsibility to stop the state, and our forefathers failed in their duty to protect us, their posterity. We now hold that responsibility. If we fail to take the actions that are required to protect ourselves, our property, and our posterity, that doesn't justify state actors who steal and murder, but it does place shame on our heads for the generations to come who we have failed to protect. Having established these uncomfortable facts, the grown-up anarchist is no longer left with the option to play nice and hope for the best. And yet, true anarchism is and must be a philosophy of peace. This seemingly contradictory position has but one solution. Since the zero aggression principle allows for violence in the pursuit of self-defense, those who are suited for such action must train and prepare for selective ethics-based decapitation of the beast. those acting on behalf of their state masters who actively murder, rape, rob, and extort have relinquished their right of property in proportion to the amount they have aggressed, and those of us with the knowledge and the skill have a responsibility to do something about it. To say it more clearly, riflemen must have a place at our table, but their actions must be principled, patient, and carefully directed. Immature stunts are not becoming of men of action. A true warrior will not be found parading about, boasting of his prowess, waving flags and pronouncing lines in the sand, while demanding marches on Washington or occupying some park bench or ranger station. The real warrior knows that fortifying sandcastles while playing army games in the forest are as childish as chalking sidewalks, yelling through megaphones, and whining about conspiracies. So if the riflemen expect to take their place at the table with the adults, they need to grow up and begin earning that place. They need to stop following self-glorifying leaders who entice them into open confrontations with the authorities. They need to understand the purpose of camouflage and stop metaphorically decorating themselves in flashing neon while screeching their intentions like a drunken redneck on a party boat. Likewise, the above-ground liberty activists will need to grow up and stop acting like spoiled children over who is being mean to whom on social networks, while expending their energy and resources trying to get governments to give them permission to use cannabis. There are more important things than arguing with communists about the meaning of the word capitalism, and debating fascists about the veneration of flags, while whining about social justice warriors. The time has come to put aside the games of your childhood and get into the battle that is about to sweep across humanity. As you will read later in this manual, it's time for the Above Ground Network to embrace its 7-part job and begin the heavy lifting it will need to do to survive what the state will throw at us before it gives up the ghost. Childish thinking and obsolete methods may have served a purpose at some time, but one thing is clear. We have moved on, and childish thinking and obsolete methods are, or should be, dead. Once a thing dies, it must be disposed of quickly, or it will rot, stink, and spread disease. Thus, we build the fires and throw the past into the flames so that we may leave behind the pain and failures of days gone by, and embrace the onslaught of challenges that the future brings. Speaking of destruction, funeral pyres, and the future, the state will not die easy. Anyone who tells you so is likely selling you snake oil while fishing for a monthly donation to their feel-good cause. The state will thrash about, wail, and strike out at anything it can reach before it dies. It will eat its own children and burn its own house before it accepts its demise. Make no mistake, the death of the beast will be an ugly sight to behold. When it dies its death, it will burn a memory in the minds of humans that they will not quickly forget. The death pangs of the great dragon will scar not only humanity, but the earth itself in such a manner that 1,000 years of erosion will not heal the wounds. And the longer we put off this fight, the more powerful the beast becomes, and the more devastating those wounds will be. Chapter 4, Section 1. Above Ground Activists. The peaceful above ground activists are now, have been, and must always be the backbone of our cause. They are our public voice and our public image. They range in description from the quiet elderly lady who has supported peace and freedom for years in her own humble way, to the college professor who will likely never reach a level of real influence in the university system due to his dedication to truth and freedom. The podcaster faithfully sharing his voice with any who will listen, and the brave freedom fighter who uses every opportunity to film the police or any other authoritarians as they beat down the innocent. The independent journalist who refuses to kowtow to authority, to the stalwart grandfather who uses wisdom in his own peaceful life as an example for his family. These and others are all examples of the activism that can provide the model of the world that we can someday possess. These activists are our sales force in the marketplace of ideas, offering a better worldview and a better product than our enemy, the state. Ultimately, it's the market that will choose the timing of the death of the state. Currently, there's a thriving market demand for the state. Most people don't understand the alternatives, nor can they imagine a world without monopolized aggression. Also, people tend to be loyal to brand-specific products, and the state is the brand mother trusted, the brand Gramps fought for during the war, and it's the only brand they ever hear about on their television. Most people have very little exposure to the violent, bloody monster that is hidden under the surface of every encounter with government agents. Many people are either employed directly or indirectly by governments, or they have close friends or relatives who are. And in the process of voting, along with the propaganda that goes with it, exists for the purposes of convincing the individual that when they vote, they create government. So when they think of government, they think of themselves or their uncle or their neighbor. When they hear about some cop beating a pregnant woman to death or shooting an old man or choking a child, they assume that that person did something to deserve such actions. How could they think otherwise? How could they condemn government when they believe they are government? This is what I mean when I say there is a market demand for the state. This explains why, when someone finally feels the fangs of the beast in their own flesh, they are shocked and horrified, and they don't understand why their precious government is behaving like it is. They'll repeat over and over, "I have faith in the system, I'm innocent, and I'll have my day in court." They'll chant their mantra, trying to change reality through their faith, or they'll insist that it's just this court, this bureaucrat, this agency, this city, this police chief that's the problem, and if we could just let someone in government know about this mix-up, then government would fix this problem. This explains why an otherwise rational mother would intentionally call the police to help with her out-of-control child. Most of the time, these sad people will maintain their faith in this myth right up to the point that the obedient government servant ends the life of their innocent child. This sad process is very much like what happens when a powerful predator grabs a small, weak animal, and the animal goes limp and seems to faint. It's our job to wake them up and encourage them to bite back. The state, for some 600 generations, has taught humans to act like a herd rather than individuals. We see the predator grab one of us, and rather than brave men and women instantly falling upon the predator, beating him senseless, we pull back and bleat or run away. We close our curtains. We change lanes. We blame the victim. But there are some that are slowly remembering who we are. There are those among us who are remembering that we are not a herd to be sheared or eaten. We are individuals capable of empathy for our fellow humans, and we are beginning to stand up to the predators. Currently, this process involves things like filming police thuggery and then exposing that thuggery on social media. Things like picking through news stories from the mainstream media and exposing the lies. Like pointing out to coworkers the travesty of taxation and the inefficiencies of central planning. Like speaking out against wars and the criminals who run the military-industrial complex. Simply teaching others about the invisible tax cult inflation and how fractional reserve central banking is a scam. Parents raising unregistered, unschooled children who understand the trivium and can explain Diocletian's problem-reaction solution. Also, parents working with other parents in support of their efforts. These people are springing up around the world. They are the above-ground network of activists, and they are no longer allowing themselves to be herded. Instead, they are making themselves heard. The above-ground activists predict the failures of the state, advertise the lies and failings of the state, and guide those who wish to learn about a greater understanding of peace, liberty, and a free life. But wait, doesn't that mean they're evangelists? Not at all. You see, there is a vast gulf between evangelists and advertising or sales. Sure, many of the tactics are similar and they share certain characteristics, but the similarity is superficial. First, there is always a level of fanaticism involved in evangelism. High emotions mixed with a dynamic personality, topped off with just a shot of over-the-top showmanship, and you have an evangelist. Your typical evangelist can sing a good song, tap out a spiffy dance, but rarely is founded in consistent principles, logic, and reason. They almost always know the basic talking points, but they have almost never delved deeper than the surface on any doctrine. They seek the big emotional conversion. Shouting from the stage with a flash of fame and the passing of the collection plate, they swoop their congregation off its feet and impart a miracle of the emotions that will hopefully last until the next performance and the next passing of the collection plate. These people should be avoided, no matter how they make you feel. The second problem, in regards to the evangelist, is his tendency to be a proselytizer. He tends not to be satisfied by simply helping those who are looking for directions, but he seems to want to rush onto the highways of life and stop traffic so he can tell everyone the way to get to the locations he thinks they should be heading towards. Typically, the evangelist's flamboyance and showmanship are only overshadowed by his incredible assumptions of self-importance. He doesn't just want to sell his goods, he wants everyone to want him. His primary product is himself, and his message is secondary at best, although usually the message comes in a distant third in importance after his stage performance. Again, we don't need these people. They are cheerleaders, have little understanding of, and no effect on the actual game. One may ask, if we don't emphasize evangelical recruiting, how will our numbers ever grow to the point that we can have a real impact? This question typically assumes two fallacies. The first and worst being the fallacy that we need a majority or we need vast numbers to win. We don't. Democracy be damned. We will never have a majority. We shouldn't care about a majority. And we don't need a majority. Market thinking isn't about majorities. Let the collectivist worry about majorities. We only need a better product, and we already have that. The second fallacy is the assumption that it is our job to recruit anarchists. It is not our job to recruit anarchists. Humans are born anarchists. It's our true nature. Tricks fool people into believing in the state. And as long as those people are comfortable in their pods clicking the feed bar, you will never be able to truly convert them to freedom. And again, we don't need to. The failings of the state do a far better job of waking up the anarchist spirit in people than any two-bit soapbox YouTube preacher ever has or ever could. Selling a product to those who are looking for that very product is vastly easier and more rewarding than evangelism. We're talking about the difference between religious fanaticism and market demand. The word evangelist comes from the word angel and literally means divinely sent messenger. Again, we don't need them. Speaking of divinely sent messengers, the hard truth is that we don't need any beloved elderly leader and former politician from Texas selling us more politics as a path to freedom any more than we need a great philosopher from Canada to enlighten us and indoctrinate us into his internet hate your mother cult. Politicians and cult leaders of any kind are worse than the cheerleading evangelists. If your version of liberty depends on a weekly message from any great man, then you are doing it wrong and this book is not aimed at you. The state is the great recruiter of anarchists. Having an intellectually stimulating conversation with your fellow polo players at the country club on a Sunday afternoon, or the internet version of that scenario played out on social media, may create a theoretical anarchist. My experience has consistently shown that these theoretical anarchists get a big thrill out of changing their online profile to include an anarchist flag and adding some phrase to their header that includes the word voluntarism or agorism. But the moment there's a boots-on-the-ground test of these theoretical anarchists, they'll start to puke status blather like beer spewing from a freshman on frat pledge night. The reason for this phenomenon is complex and unnecessary to evaluate here. For the purpose of this manual, all we need to keep in mind is that the state does the job that rhetorical hoop jumping simply can't accomplish. Telling a person about the boot of the state may stimulate them intellectually, but when an officer friendly actually drags their child out of a car and beats him half to death, the change of heart is real and permanent. Our job is to guide that change of heart and encourage others to be empathetic. The state is its own worst enemy. It will kill itself. The question is, will we let it live long enough to take all of us out with it when it goes? Right now you should be asking, short of having everyone's child sacrificed to the state to prove we're right about the state, what can we do? Chapter 4, Section 1, Part 1. The Seven-Part Job. The Above Ground Network's seven-part job, in order of priority, number 1, Provide for yourself and your family. Dependence is the opposite of independence. The optimum situation is to secure an income stream that doesn't depend on the state. However, if providing for your family means a government job that doesn't require you to directly aggress upon the innocent, then you have to do what you have to do to survive. Not everyone has the luxury of an optimum situation, so first provide as best you can. Number two, strive for consistent principled behavior in your own life. To steal a phrase, rather than focusing on the splinter in your neighbor's eye, you should make sure there's not a log in your own. If you believe what you say, you will live it. If you aren't living what you say, you don't believe it. Living a principled life is a reward of its own. You don't have to wait for some coming glory or some pie in the sky. When you look in the mirror and you know the person looking back is genuine, and when you close your eyes at night knowing you have been true to yourself, you will live a happier life. Number three. Prepare for the systematic failure of the state. Beans, band-aids, Bitcoin, bullion, and bullets. Survivalists and preppers have endured concentrated defamation by believers in the state. This fact alone means we should take note of their activities because they're doing something that scares statists. That's not to say we should believe every foil hat-wearing wacky doodle with a survival website or podcast. We shouldn't. Some of them are seriously disjointed, and some of them are pure con men running scams on the gullible. But being connected to the prepper community and being prepared for a variety of natural or man-made disasters is never a bad idea. Having a disaster plan and having a get-out-of-dodge plan should be standard operating procedure. Also, having a skill set that includes some survival and do-it-yourself abilities is never a bad thing. For example, every parent should know some basic first aid. Number four, help those who you can help and let go of those whom you cannot help. Emergency workers are trained in triage so that they may assign the priority of treatment based on the degree of injuries or illnesses of a large number of patients. For me, the most difficult part of triage is when you recognize the patient's condition is such that you cannot save them, and helping them will prevent you from helping someone else. You don't want to walk away, but you can't stay. Some simply cannot be saved. That's not to say you must shun family or friends. It doesn't mean you should defoo anyone. It means you must come to grips with the fact that some will never leave the mental comfort of slavery. They will cling to their chains to their last breath. Accept it and move on with your life. It's not your job to force slaves into freedom. Number five, expose the evil and lies of the state as you speak the truth in the face of power. One of the hardest things a person can do is stand on the truth when the world around you is swimming in lies. One of the bravest things a person can do is speak truth in the face of power. Some state this phrase as speak truth to power. But as others have shown, that statement is flawed as it indicates that we should seek to change the minds of those in political power by influencing them with our words. We should not. Attempting to influence those who hold political power to do our will morally places us in the same category as every other person who uses the political means to achieve their goals. Speaking truth in the face of power indicates that we are speaking in spite of the threat we face. We are not speaking to power, we are speaking truth to posterity, and the powers be damned. Number six, publicly disassociate yourself from the underground, denouncing all acts of aggression. This requires a delicate balance. There are times when we can carefully take a lesson from our enemy. A myriad of politicians over the last few thousand years have turned double talk into an art form. By that, I mean answering a direct pointed question by talking around the topic while boldly announcing some ethical point that is very similar to the question but doesn't directly address the question. In doing this, one can avoid telling a lie while avoiding the question. For example, if the topic of violent anarchist causes someone to accuse you of supporting violence, you can explain the zero aggression principle. or non-aggression principle, if you prefer that terminology. And you can further explain that some people who call themselves anarchists are actually communists and socialists, and they do tend towards violence and destruction, since they don't have any respect for property ownership. However, peaceful anarchists embrace the zero aggression principle, so we reject all initiation of aggression, and we respect the property of peaceful people. When you take that path, deception may be employed, and some say there is no difference between deception and a lie, but that is a matter for the individual to decide for their situation. However, if you actually discipline yourself to avoid acts of aggression and commit yourself to peaceful means, this task of dissociation becomes much easier. But no matter the method, there must be a public disassociation between peaceful activism and the underground. Number 7. Safely engage in direct activism. Things like filming the police, podcasting, or other activities, or quietly providing support for the underground according to your abilities and resources. That support doesn't necessarily require money or direct contact. There are many things the individual may do to support the underground without directly interacting with those activists. Again, your imagination is a required tool in this endeavor. Or, if you have carefully examined yourself and you are one of the few uniquely suited for direct involvement in the underground movement, then pursue that path with care and wisdom. Chapter 4, Section 1, Part 2. Film the police while you can. Filming police in America is an important form of activism right now, but this situation is temporary. Governments worldwide, including the American government, have or will shut this window the moment they think they can get away with it. Currently, there are several great organizations who are emphasizing the importance of filming the police, and they're training more and more people on how to safely do so. In America, these activists have given the state its most serious bloody nose of modern times. Right now, the U.S. government is stuck with old legal decisions and definitions that force it to not only allow the recording of police, but to actually protect those who are bold enough to do so. But as I said, that will rapidly change. Either courts will simply shift their legal protections away from those doing the filming, or what is more likely, some grand event will take place and the media and the full force of its propaganda wing will descend on the activists, demonizing them. In all likelihood, this will be some kind of big tragic event somehow caused by someone filming the police, and most likely it will involve the deaths of police or perhaps even children. Of course, this event will be staged, or if real, perhaps entirely orchestrated by the state for the purpose of shifting public opinion towards condemning those who film the police. An aspect of the solution to this terrible tragedy will be a federal level government emphasis on police forces filming themselves. Vast amounts of federal funding will assure a solution to this horrible event. Maybe even a whole new department of federal employees will be hired to film the police for us. In reality, of course, government filming themselves only means more surveillance on the public and more police control of the actual recordings produced. Police will get better at producing fake videos, and the bulk of the public will buy the ruse without question. The two action items here are, 1. Get as many activists filming police as possible while preparing those activists for the propaganda storm that will hit when the false flag event happens. 2. Prepare for the time to come when it will be illegal to film the police. The filming must continue after it becomes illegal, but it will need to take a much more clandestine approach. If you just read that last paragraph and thought to yourself, if we know a false flag event is coming and will likely be staged or orchestrated, why not just expose it as fake when it happens? Fear not, friend. There is already an army of activists waiting with bated breath for each new false flag event so that they can be the one exposing its fraud. We are well represented in that field of battle. For more information, just do an internet search for the phrase crisis actor. However, the bulk of the public will believe the government lies no matter how poorly constructed and no matter how carefully debunked. What about filming after the state forbids it? The black market exists only because the white market has become dangerous or forbidden. The same is true with activism. We can't allow laws and thuggery to determine our path. We must do what must be done. Chapter 4, Section 2. Fictional Beings and Their Property. Join me in a thought exercise. The setup. We understand that according to consistent libertarian philosophy, every human has the exact same rights as every other human. So a child has the same right of property as an adult. Humans own themselves and have the right to own other property that they have rightfully come to possess. We believe that two people may engage in voluntary transaction, transferring the rightful ownership of property from one party to the other, and no one else may rightfully interfere. Libertarians also believe that unowned property can rightfully be homesteaded. This is not an exhaustive explanation of libertarian property theory, but it is suitable for this thought experiment. Phase 1. With the above being the case, let us consider Sally, a child who owns a ball. Sally was given the ball by her mother, Betty, who purchased the ball from a market. The ownership of the ball has not been in question up to the time that Sally decided to give the ball to her imaginary friend, Canada. Sally imagines Canada as an intelligent 9-foot half-zebra, half-ape creature wearing a clown outfit. Sally deeply believes in Canada, believes she has relinquished ownership, and believes she no longer owns the ball. It's Canada's ball, and Sally won't touch it. Question number 1. Can the fictional creature Canada rightfully own the ball? Phase 2. Every aspect of the above still remains except Sally is joined in her fiction by Billy, her real-life neighbor who also believes in Canada. Question number 2. Does the union of Sally and Billy in their belief in the fictional being Canada change the ownership of the ball? Phase 3. Every aspect of the above still remains, except Sally's mother, Betty, also believes in Canada. Question number 3. Does the authority of Betty, along with the union of Sally and Billy and their belief in the fictional being Canada, change the ownership of the ball? Phase 4. This phase has a dramatic change. Sally's mother, Betty, stole the money she used to buy the ball. She is an outstanding pickpocket, and over the course of a day of theft, she stole money from 73 people, totaling $418. Betty has no idea who those people were, and it's impossible to find out who they were or to return their share of the stolen money. With that money, Betty purchased groceries, gasoline, the ball for Sally, and she ate lunch at a restaurant, tipping the waiter generously. Upon leaving the restaurant, Betty saw a homeless man picking through a trash can, so she gave the man a $20 bill. Every other aspect of the story remains the same. Sally gave the ball to Canada, while Billy and Betty both believe in Canada. Question number 4. Who owns the ball? Let me rephrase the question. Can an unrealistic, fictional, non-human entity own property purchased with untraceable stolen money? And does Betty's charity affect the question of property ownership? If, at this point, you would argue that the fictional person Canada actually owns a ball, then our conversation would be over. I wouldn't bother attempting a debate with someone who believes such outlandish fantasies. However, if you don't believe Canada can rightfully own property, why would you believe an equally ridiculous, unrealistic, fictional, non-human entity called the United States government can own property? But wait, there's more! Phase crazy. Canada is no longer named Canada. Canada is now named General Energy. Sally, Billy, and Betty believe they work for General Energy, or GE, as they call it. The U.S. government has issued a slip of paper that declares GE a legal, quote-unquote, person. GE receives millions of dollars in stolen money, or taxes, from the U.S. government every year in government contracts, and in return, Sally, Billy, and Betty make guns that GE sells to the U.S. government. The U.S. government then uses those guns to collect the taxes that it pays to GE for more guns. Betty, using the legal authority granted by the U.S. government, uses GE's money to buy a ball for GE. Question number 5. Now who rightfully owns the ball? The consistent libertarian should always have the same answer. The ball is unowned property. Anyone may rightfully homestead it and do with it as they please because imaginary fictional beings can't own property in the real world. This principle is not changed by the number of people believing the fiction, nor by the authority of people believing the fiction, nor by their acts of charity. And just because some old farts who call themselves justices or any other gang of delusional people with made-up titles of glory use enforcer thugs to beat, cage, or kill anyone who disagrees, it doesn't change the reality of what is right and what is wrong. Nor is reality changed by the passage of time. So just because your father and his father before him believed in a 9-foot-tall, half-zebra, half-ape named Canada, that doesn't make it so. There are those who will attempt to argue that somehow the ball belongs to all of us. These people believe in, quote-unquote, public property. They will use convoluted collectivist property rights theories to show that since we are all robbed, then we all have ownership in the ball. To make this argument, you must abandon libertarian principles and, largely, logic itself. You have to create an imaginary world where you can theoretically own something without ever having seen it, touched it, or possibly even been aware of its existence. You would have to be able to own property that you can't possess or interact with in any way, and that you have no influence as to whether others may or may not interact with it. So then the question becomes, can you own a ball that you don't know exists and that someone else can play with or destroy at their will while you have no say in its destiny? If you believe so, I wonder, do you also have a special friend named Canada? At this point, I should address the property of corporations that are not in crony or codependent relationship with governments. Let us say that an old man and an old woman have a little shoe sales / repair shop and have been running this humble business for years. Lately, the neighborhood has changed, property values have skyrocketed, and their little niche business is expanding daily. They have to hire employees, expand their shop, and have added a little tea shop in the building next door. For years, they have been running their business as a simple, quote-unquote, DBA. But now, their accountant advises them that their business is at great risk if they don't form a corporation to protect it. Their actions to protect their business are morally very different from the actions of a corporation that is dependent upon their relationship with government. If there is or if there is not a magic paper distinguishing the difference between the mom-and-pop shoe store and some corporations that is the exclusive shoe supplier to the prison industrial complex, there is still a moral difference. The old man and the old woman are reacting to the threat of theft by government or government-assisted entities, whereas the other corporation is facilitating and profiting from that theft. Every moral anarchist should understand this difference in the same way that we understand that it is immoral to rob people to pay for roads, but it is not immoral to use that road once it is built. The difference being active robbery and a reaction to a robbery after the fact. To blame a victim for their reaction to a crime is shifting the responsibility away from the criminal and onto the victim. If I have done my job here, then we can agree that property in the possession of fictional beings is rightfully unowned, in spite of the fact that there are people willing to kill on command for that fictional being. So rightfully, all state property, remember the definition of the state, including the property of governments, their crony churches, their crony corporations, the banking cartels, the mainstream media, all of it is unowned and rightfully open for homesteading. Once homesteaded, the new owner may rightfully do with it as he or she pleases, so long as he or she doesn't initiate aggression on the rightfully owned property of another real person. An example could be a window of a government vehicle. I could homestead it and immediately decide I wanted to break it. Rightfully, I could do so without violating libertarian property rights or without violating the zero aggression principle. However, the odds are the window is protected by a violent nutjob that believes in Canada and will shoot me down like a rabid dog, given the opportunity. Yes, he would be the aggressor, and yes, I could rightfully protect myself. But remember, wisdom provides the balance between what I can rightfully do and what I should do. Most freedom-loving activists should not engage in violence in support of liberty, even justifiable violence. Most people are not very well endowed to deal with physical and mental challenges and the responsibilities that come with violence. However, the wise activist who is naturally suited for violence but is still dedicated to the zero aggression principle has a choice of the types of activism to be engaged in. Simple sabotage is such a wide field of activism that the friend of freedom can carefully and safely choose the level and type of simple sabotage that best suits their individual situation. On the other hand, ethics-based irregular warfare requires a high level of self-discipline coupled with a very special skill set. Not every gun owner, for example, or former military, in spite of what they may think, is suited for the challenges of the early stages of irregular warfare. Near the end of the life of the state, we may not have the luxury of choosing to be involved in war or not. But today, while we can plan, and the cities have not yet become glowing ashen craters, it is critical that the actions of the irregular warriors be wise, carefully planned, and be executed with extreme caution and secrecy. More specific details on ethics-based irregular warfare and simple sabotage can be found in Sedition, Subversion, and Sabotage Field Manual No. 1 in the section titled Ethics-Based Irregular Warfare and in the section titled Simple Sabotage. Chapter 4, Section 3, The Above Ground and the Underground. When the above ground activist considers getting involved in the underground, an old saying applies. Discretion is the greater part of valor. If you're not careful in whom you support and what activity you support, you may be taking far more risk than you should. Consider the case of Samuel Mudd, the physician who set the broken leg of John Wilkes Booth. There were very loose connections between Booth and Mudd, and little to no connections between Mudd and the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and yet, in a frenzy to convict, a military court found Mudd guilty of aiding and conspiring in the murder, and he was sentenced to life imprisonment, escaping the death penalty by one vote. Laurie Fortier may have narrowly escaped a similar fate after the bombing of the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building in downtown Oklahoma City on April 19, 1995. Apparently, she helped Timothy McVeigh laminate a fake driver's license that he later used to secure a rental truck that carried a bomb on that fateful day. Any more involvement by Lori is based on conjecture at best. However, rather than see her name railroaded through a kangaroo court and punished for something she had nothing to do with, her husband flipped and became a government stooge. Had he not done so, she may have faced the same unreasonable guilt by association that Mudd had suffered. The hard, ugly lesson being, supporting underground activists can be extremely dangerous. Know who you support and get some kind of idea as to their activities. Otherwise, if they fail or botch their getaway, you may suffer for crimes you had nothing to do with. In the vast majority of situations, the above-ground activists should have no association with the activities of the underground, and at some point in the future, even knowing who they are will be extremely dangerous. The best course of action will always be to disassociate yourself from the underground in every way. Publicly disavow them, and publicly renounce them. And never allow yourself to have financial connections with them, as this will be an easy route the state will use to track down the underground and punish all involved. Chapter 4, Section 3, Part 1. The Sabotage Pincer and the Above Ground Pincer. Hackers and friend saboteurs should work to agitate the state by seeking out weaknesses in its security, transportation, manufacturing, and communication infrastructures, then exploiting those weaknesses, if possible, to cause systematic failure or at least confusion. At the point of systematic failure, the hackers and friend saboteurs' work is done, and the above ground becomes the point of agitation by constantly advertising the failures of central planning and forced compliance, while trumpeting the advantages of spontaneous order and peaceful voluntarism. This is the essence of the dual pincers of the scorpion. This type of agitation causes the state to overreact, and because of the nature of the state, that overreaction is always some kind of violent authoritarianism. As has been stated over and over, when you only have a hammer, every problem looks like a nail, and with the state, that means every problem becomes an opportunity for the state to pound someone. This violent overreaction by authoritarians presents the second opportunity for the above-ground activists to point out the evil nature of government and again advertise the advantages of spontaneous order and peaceful voluntarism. Therefore, if done correctly, every successful action of the hackers and friend saboteurs pays off twice for the above-ground in opportunities to bring shame on those who still support the state and in offering a moral solution. This is the metaphor behind the term Lego distribution network. The idea being that as soon as the state is asleep, we slip in and spread Legos on the carpet. Then, in the middle of the night, when the state gets up to go to the bathroom, he will step on them. Hopefully he will stumble and fall down the stairs, but even if he doesn't fall, we will know that we are bringing him pain and aggravation. The above ground and the underground can also work separately to reveal as much information as possible about specific state supporters of aggression. This can involve public revelations of the inner workings of the so-called shadow governments, or double governments, described by Michael Glennon and discussed later in this manual. These public revelations can include information about how double governments work, how politicians are actually powerless and are simply a show for the public, and how foreign and domestic policies are created to control the masses, not to keep them safe. In addition to this critical work, the above ground and the underground can also work separately to veil private and personal information about key figures in the double government so that the stinger of the scorpion can have the sufficient information that it needs to facilitate the decision-making process when a stinging strike is required. The above ground and the underground can be the eyes of the stinger. Of course, the obvious warning has to be inserted here. Whenever the state reacts to the above-described agitation, activists of all kinds should be as far out of reach of the state as possible. This is why invisibility and security are so critical to all components of the underground networks, and it's why the above ground must have no direct ties to the underground. Consider the case of journalist Barrett Brown, who boldly and bravely supported the hacker collective, Anonymous, while writing news releases about their exploits and helping to build a wiki to facilitate analysis of their hacktivism. Even though Barrett never did any hacking, when the U.S. government and its crony cohorts at Stratfor suffered an embarrassing email leak in 2011, Barrett became a convenient whipping boy to be singled out and punished as an example for the rest of us. Journalists like Brown and others who have suffered even worse for their profession, such as Michael Hastings and Gary Webb, walk a narrow tightrope balancing between their drive to expose the truth and the tendency to become part of the story. All the while, standing in the open completely exposed to the slings and arrows of the state's fury. But for the rest of the above ground, the best defense against being punished for the actions of the underground is to have no discoverable connections to the underground, and, of course, a consistent public history of denouncing them won't hurt your case either. Chapter 4, Section 3, Part 2. The Stinger. Natural Law, Defense, and Aggression. I am intentionally being vague in this section of the manual in reference to ethics-based selective irregular warfare, as it is covered more completely and carefully in the section of this manual appropriately named Ethics-Based Selective Irregular Warfare. Among the reasons for being imprecise in this regard, in addition to the obvious reason of avoiding redundancies, is because at some point this manual may be physically divided into its three parts, and those who need to read this section will have no need of being associated with those who have a need to read that section. In other words, it may be important for some activists to physically possess a copy of this section of the manual that doesn't contain the other two sections. That said, by abandoning the trivium while embracing the Prussian education system, Western governments have systematically stymied the ability of many people to examine an ethical dilemma, break it down to its core questions, and develop a consistent logical solution. For that reason, a simple transitive equation such as the following can confuse some people. If A is greater than B and B is greater than C, then the equation A is greater than C can be assumed to be true without separate analysis. What one sees when interacting with many otherwise intelligent people is that they have, for example, adopted A is less than C as dogma for a variety of reasons, and can simply not re-examine their position despite the fact that they still agree that A is greater than B and B is greater than C. This is often the source of the problem we face when attempting to explain questions of ethics using grammar, logic, and rhetoric, while contradicting tradition and authority. Many otherwise intelligent people simply cannot wrap their minds around concepts that are contradictive to what they have been taught. To put that statement in beer gut terminology, no matter what your mama, your teachers, or some liberty great man told you, what I am about to lay on you is truth, so grab your socks before you get clipped in the neck. There are laws throughout nature waiting to be discovered on an as-needed basis. In and of themselves, they are neither good nor evil. Gravity, for example, is not good nor is it evil. It simply is. We wouldn't say that the man who falls to his death is a victim of evil gravity. That would be absurd. Yet, when we see something that seems to defy natural law, we quickly recognize that something is not quite right, and we tend to want to know why. We literally discover law through investigation and the resulting understanding of how things in nature work. This can be demonstrated by showing a simple sleight of hand trick to a human child or even some other animals. A well-known internet video shows an orangutan viewing a magic trick. The ape is both amazed and humored. The reason he shows such an interest in the trick is because he knows something has happened that seems to defy what he understands to be natural law, and his curiosity drives him to fascination with the phenomenon. All animals have a certain built-in understanding of their role in nature and in the limits of nature. The same goes for the behavior of any animal. The lioness is not evil for providing her cubs with the flesh of a gazelle. She is simply following the law. Her behavior is required to preserve the lives of her offspring. If the gazelle had been able to escape the jaws of the lioness and the cubs had gone hungry, the gazelle would not be considered evil for starving the cubs. The lioness is following natural law, as is the gazelle when it seeks the opposite result of the encounter. In such an encounter, natural law is not contradictive. It is beautifully consistent and a source of life and true peace. Evil, then, is what humans perceive when we see natural law violated in an unjust way by a human. Specifically, when one human unjustly uses violence or threats of violence on another human, we know this is wrong the same way the orangutan knows there is something not right about the magic trick. The difference being that at times, humans choose to violate natural law through an unjustified violence. And this is why self-defense must enter the equation to fully understand the relationship of natural law and peace. Since self-defense is a reaction of the breaking of natural law, not an original action in and of itself, it is exempt from law, and its execution is at the discretion of the person acting in self-defense. So, for example, if man A initiates violence on man B by punching man B in the nose, we may hope or expect man B to retaliate by punching man A back in return. However, we may not see justification for man B if he sprayed gasoline on man A and set him on fire. Most people would perceive the fire as an overreaction. But do we have the natural right to make that judgment? Did we feel the pain, the fear, the trauma? Have we lived man B's life? Do we know what it means to be man B and be attacked by man A? This is the difference between natural law and civil behavior, and some have argued that is the basis of civil law. Natural law says that once man A initiated the confrontation, the judgment of what is a just punishment is rightfully in the hands of man B, and he alone. Only man B knows what it is like to be man B and suffer that specific assault by man A. Where civil behavior enters the equation is in the fact that the rest of us may or may not want to live around someone who would burn a man to death over a punch in the nose. So we rightfully may exclude man B from association, but there is nothing in natural law that would condemn man B for his chosen form of retaliation. In the last 5,000 years or so, judgments in civil behavior gave rise to agreements, and eventually they became codes of acceptable civil behavior. Eventually, limits were placed both on self-defense and retaliation, and governments became the so-called authority of justice. In the case of Hammurabi's code, for example, retaliation was unnaturally enforced by government at the arbitrary line of eye for eye, tooth for tooth, bone for bone, and as all government programs tend to do, agreements and civil behavior became incredibly intrusive laws enforced at the point of a spear, controlling everything from contract law to sexual forbiddances to wage and price controls, and government began dictating punishments that depended upon the social ranking and wealth of the offender and the victim. All of this within the scope of Hammurabi's code. So what we see when we compare natural law with civil behavior is that natural law is never arbitrary, is fair, and always pushes us towards survival of our species, while civil behavior tends to be based on secondary observations by those who have no natural right to judge the matter, and tends to drift towards unfairness and intrusions based on social standing and wealth, where punishments are handed down from government officials. In other words, civil rules of behavior and second-party judgments must never supersede natural laws and primary party judgments. Otherwise, natural laws get replaced by government edicts, and even the original civil rules become null and void as tyranny replaces freedom, and justice becomes a commodity to be purchased at a government-set price. This leads us to consider self-defense and possibly discover an aspect of natural law. Remember, the aggressive man A and his violent attack on man B? Is it possible that man B's overreaction to the punch in the nose could have been avoided if he spotted the threat man A presented and acted in preemptive self-defense? If man B had recognized man A's intent to punch, and once there was no doubt the event was imminent, if man B had struck first, would man B not have been more evenly tempered to judge the follow-through retaliation against his attacker, having not been subjected to the disorientating effects of the nose punch? In other words, perhaps if man B had acted in preemptive self-defense, there would be no need for the naysayers to wag their fingers in civil judgment of his action, because he very likely never would have set Man A on fire. In all likelihood, the event would have ended with Man A being taught a quick lesson by way of a few bruises, and with Man B avoiding humiliation, pain, and the judgment of his peers. Natural law drives the species toward survival, as both men come out better for the encounter. Thus, we see that preemptive violence can be an act of self-defense and is consistent with natural law. If, on the other hand, Man A simply can't learn this lesson, perhaps we are all better off without him in the gene pool. But that is not for us to judge. It is for his next victim to decide. This leads to our next step in discovering natural law in regards to self-defense. If you have knowledge that a man is stalking your child with the intent to harm her, you are following natural law when you interrupt the man's aggression before he harms your child. And if that man has a history of murdering innocent children, you are under no moral obligation to spare his life in the defense of your child before he has a chance to act. In a situation such as this, preemptive defense is not only wise, but within the natural law definition of ethical action. Many adherents to the zero aggression principle attempt to argue that we may not defend ourselves until after the physical aggression has been initiated by the attacker. This is illogical for several reasons, the first of which is that true defense, by its nature, involves the presentation to the potential attacker that the prospect that an attack will have a price, so that the attacker can choose to avoid the confrontation to begin with. Otherwise, we would be considered baiting the attacker if the attacker has the impression that he may have the first strike, quote-unquote, free. Remember, almost every dangerous or poisonous animal in nature has clear markings to warn its attackers. After all, in many situations, the attacker who has his first shot free often leaves the victim incapable of self-defense after that first strike. For example, I am about 6 feet tall and weigh about 240 pounds. Additionally, I have trained in personal combat, including the European martial art of pugilism. If I, or someone of comparable size and skill, were to get a totally free bare-knuckle first punch in a fight, the fight would likely be instantly over, no matter the size, strength, or training of the victim. That is clearly not a natural law situation that advances our species or promotes peace. So then, natural law provides for preemptive self-defense while remaining within the constraints of the zero aggression principle. Now consider the following. According to the FBI, in 2014, burglary losses in the U.S. topped out at about $3.5 billion. In that same year, according to the Institute for Justice, U.S. quote-unquote law enforcement stole $4.5 billion using asset forfeiture laws. Don't be confused by such a huge number by thinking that massive amounts of money was taken from big-time drug dealers, because that didn't happen. The median forfeiture in 2014 was less than $500. Now ask yourself how you would treat a known burglar. If half of all burglars wore distinctive uniforms with a clearly displayed badge indicating they are a burglar, how would you treat them? Would they be safe walking down your street? Would they be safe sitting in a clearly marked car in your neighborhood? Now consider that there were roughly 20,000 no-knock raids in the U.S. in 2014, and that number is rising every year. The largest crime gang in the world already wear uniforms, carry military-grade weapons, and steal more from peaceful people than all of their competitors combined, and that doesn't count what is stolen in taxes and through inflation. The above being the case, if we have clearly demonstrated that a specific institution is based on intimidation, violence, and theft, And if we have demonstrated that specific employees or representatives of that institution have a proven record of using intimidation, violence, and theft to advance that institution and themselves, and if we have demonstrated that said representatives of said institutions are both willing, capable, and at some point in the future, likely to repeat such aggression upon ourselves, our loved ones, or other equally innocent victims, then we are not under obligation to wait until that specific aggressor strikes the first blow against us or our families. If both the institution and the representative of that institution are known to kill the innocent, we have no obligation to limit our use of force when defending ourselves and our family from that aggressor. Actually, much like the lioness above, it is our natural responsibility to preserve our family and remove threats before they can do harm. And, like the law of gravity, the natural law of self-defense cannot be logically described as evil. It simply is. Back to beer gut terminology, they are in our towns, they are in our neighborhoods, and they are daily entering our homes and having their way with our property and our loved ones. They don't think we can or will do a thing about it, but they are wrong. We can and we will stop them. But we must do it wisely. We cannot foolishly play into their hands through open confrontation.
Chapter 5, Technology, Hacking, and Secure Communications. One of the most obvious shortcomings of this manual will be the lack of specifics in the fields of technology and hacking. The reason is that the hacking world moves and changes so fast that a manual such as this would be outdated to the point of laughter before I could consult the right people, translate from hackerese to American English, and publish it. Also, to a large extent, the hacker community has a far better grasp of most of the concepts outlined in this manual, since they have been in the fields fighting the good fight, taking serious risks, while the bulk of the liberty movement were either engaged in arguments on social media or waving signs at a 420 rally. Not to say social media and 420 rallies are bad, they just don't compare to being sentenced to 3 life sentences in a federal penitentiary for running a forum or being murdered and having it staged like a suicide because of a few lines of code. This is the reason that this manual is of the least value to the technology hacking activists. However, I will touch on a few items. Operation Security, or OPSEC, is a science in and of its own. I am neither qualified nor motivated to devote 500 pages to the topic. One partial reason is that by 2009, as I investigated Internet OPSEC, I became convinced that the typical Internet culture version of OPSEC was pretty much a faith-based fantasy. If you hold radical political beliefs, someone in a government office likely knows about it. They read or copy pretty much everything. Even if they aren't currently watching you and your specific activities, because they keep a record of almost everything, they can retroactively find out almost anything they want to know about you. A case in point is Ross Ulbricht, the alleged Dread Pirate Roberts. With an incredibly weak case against him, government investigators searched old entries at internet locations like the Mises Institute to build a dossier based on usernames similar to his and writing styles like his to determine an IP profile. Using weak connections like that, they focused in on Ross and warped the actual evidence in the case to convince a dim-witted jury that he was a devil incarnate. It didn't really matter if Ross was innocent, guilty, or anywhere in between. He was their target, and they were going to catch him and make an example of him simply because slave masters love to beat the whipping boy, and Ross was a textbook whipping boy. Now consider the case of Matt DeHart, former U.S. Air National Guard intelligence analyst allegedly involved in an attempt to expose the CIA's involvement in the 2001 anthrax scare. Without enough actual evidence to convict Matt, authorities chose to seize his computers and plant images resulting in child pornography charges. One may ask why so much time and effort was invested into the Ulbricht case when they could have just faked the evidence like they did in the DeHart case. The obvious answer is hidden in the fact that government agents working on the Dread Pirate Roberts case have been proven guilty of absconding with a fortune in Bitcoin that they stole from the Silk Road, and no such source of funding was available in the DeHart case. So they took the easy, time-tested route of planting evidence on computer hard drives that the government had complete access to with no way to prove it wasn't Matt's pornography. So does that mean we should just throw caution to the wind and forget about internet security and private communications? Not at all. It means those in the underground should not worry about or try to be totally invisible, but we should learn and practice communicating in ways that assure the best security that is possible for the things that matter. One thing that helps us do that is that the above-ground activists practice secure communications for things that don't need to be private, if for no other reason, to keep the watchers busy watching things that don't matter. Chapter 5, Section 1, Secure Communications. As covered above in regards to activist networks, communication systems can be centralized, decentralized, or distributed in structure. An example of a currently working 2016 distributed communication system that provides good functionality but doesn't rely on any centralized host is Talks.chat. It allows private chat, group chat, and file sharing and is encrypted end-to-end, although the PC itself can still be compromised. It's a direct replacement for unsecured chat and secured chat that is centrally hosted. Currently, the download and use are free of charge. Another distributed project which is way more comprehensive towards secure communications and file sharing is RetroShare, and is more like a private bulletin board system where you can post files and messages for others to download later. Neither of these two are very hard to set up, but they do both require the participants to somehow exchange their keys, preferably in a secure way, in order to connect to each other. Coupling either of the two distributed systems above with an operating system like Tails, which gives out-of-the-box anonymity over Tor, can give us a private secure setup like we've never seen before, and it's not too hard to set up. There are other systems like this coming out all the time, making the idea of putting such a topic in print seem rather silly.
Chapter 6, Homework and Conclusion. Homework Assignment A. Assuming you have made it this far and completed this first section of this manual, I would like to assign some reading before you continue to the next section. The reason for this homework is to drive home the concept that the thing that public sees as government is not the state, and indeed, it is not even government. The political process, with all its politicians, its posturing, its political campaigns, its elections, and all of its quasi-religious ceremonies, is in fact an elaborate opera played out by actors for your entertainment. The entire show is nothing more than an ongoing intravenous drip of political opiates to keep the public in a stupor. Actual government policies are the result of a hidden government made up of unelected semi-permanent bureaucrats who kindly play along with the politicians while doing almost all of the work of running the apparatus of government. If you complete this homework assignment, you will find the above statement is not a wild-eyed, foil-hat conspiracy. It is simply how the real world of government works, and if you complete this assignment, you will see a major flaw in the very fabric of government that is just waiting for someone to yank the thread and unravel the whole cloth. The assignment. Read, or at least skim the short book, National Security and Double Government by Michael Glennon, 2014. Michael Glennon is professor of international law at the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy at Tufts University. He is a respected Washington, D.C. policymaker and insider. He is not an anarchist, he is not a conspiracy wacko, and he is not a whistleblower with an axe to grind. He is a solid statist who is being brutally honest with his colleagues and describing a flaw that he perceives in American government. Although insightful in regards to the national security intelligence state, and revealing in his indictment of the process of selecting U.S. Supreme Court justices and U.S. presidents, Michael Glennon seems to ignore or not be aware of the struggle between the hidden government that he talks about and the public government in the post-World War II years, culminating in the assassination of a sitting U.S. president. Perhaps he didn't want to muddy the waters with the topic, but ignoring such an event in conjunction with his lacking an assessment of the obvious meddling by the central banks and their owners in regards to monetary policy, and the massive influence of the military-industrial complex, the pharmaceutical complex, the energy complex, and the industrial farming interests have all played, is disturbing to say the least. Again, perhaps there were constraints in time, or perhaps he chose to only focus on the national security intelligence issues because of his target audience, or perhaps because he wished to keep the discussion in his realm of excellence. For whatever his reason, and considering the precision in his assessment, it is sad that he didn't follow through to a better conclusion than to just say that voters should be better educated. This failure stands out most dramatically when you consider that he never even once hints at the incredible level of aggression and violence that his so-called Trumanites have relied upon to gain and maintain their grip on governments. Also, when you consider that the very system of Trumanites that he describes existed in America before the date he points to as their official birth, and in fact controlled major aspects of the American government long before Harry Truman was born, his warnings seem far too little, far too late. And again, to assume more education could be the solution, considering the American education system was one of the first targets of the hidden government in the late 1800s, seems like a weak conclusion at best. More to the interest of readers of this manual is the glaring weaknesses inherent in the American government that Glennon so carefully and accurately points out. From his article, quote, "The aim of this article thus far has been to explain the continuity in U.S. national security policy. An all-too-plausible answer, this article has suggested, lies in Bagehot's concept of double government. Bagehot believed that double government could survive only so long as the general public remained sufficiently credulous to accept the superficial appearance of accountability, and only so long as the concealed and public elements of the government are able to mask their duality and thereby sustain public deference. As evidence of duality becomes plainer and public skepticism grows, however, Bagehot believed that the cone of governance will be balanced on its points. If you push it ever so little, it will depart further and further from its position and fall to the earth." End quote. Restating Walter Bagehot, Glennon lays out for us what we should already know. Modern Western-style government is entirely based on the lie that visible politics run governments, when actually the hidden and plain sight truth is that visible politics play almost no role in the actual policies of government, and the most important point of both Bagehot and Glennon being that the whole house of cards is at risk of collapse if the public fully figures it out. That leads us to the point of this manual, how to capitalize on that wonderful weakness and shove the cone of governance off of its balance point so that we may all shout with glee as Humpty Dumpty tumbles to the earth. Homework assignment B. Think of ways you can assist the underground without being directly connected to the underground. Here are some examples, but see if you can think of more. Number 1. Do you know or have an interest in lockpicking? This would be a great skill set to learn and teach to those in the underground. Number 2. Are you an actor or are you talented in that art? Could you develop acting troops that could use their talent in the underground? You could practice at Liberty functions and get together by fooling the participants into thinking you were building inspectors, FBI agents, or worse. Above ground activists with experience in specific fields can work as advisors, as in, how do corrections officers behave? How do federal marshals transport prisoners? How do police talk to each other when no one is listening? For example, the movie Burn After Reading lost my attention when the great character actor, J.K. Simmons, played the unnamed CIA supervisor and began to talk. The few CIA operators I have known were nothing like that. The CIA agents I have encountered use very clean language. They were Mormons, and they were very dedicated and straight-laced, all business, all the time. In my experience, as good of an actor as J.K. Simmons is, I wouldn't believe for a second that he was an actual CIA agent. Under the right circumstances, a mistake like that could cost an activist dearly. Number 3. Medical personnel, specifically those with trauma and emergency room experience, can hold classes teaching emergency first aid to members of the underground. Number 4. Organize the ambassador system with other anarchist and activist groups to provide them services during demonstrations, riots, and other times. Perhaps film crews, news coverage, medical assistance, logistics, communications, alerts about police movements, or other services could be offered without getting directly involved in the causes or their demonstrations. Note on other groups. Do not repeat the mistake Rothbard made with the racist right. Infiltrate them, but do not water down our movement by evangelizing them. Do not trust them. Invade their circles, but do not let them in ours. Number 5. Train rescue teams before demonstrations, riots, so that teams can rush in and remove injured protesters before they can be arrested, possibly even after they are arrested. Training teams for spotting agents provocateur, identifying shadow teams, and even shadowing these shadow teams while communicating their movements could be very important. Identifying arrest teams and communicating arrest team movements before they act, and even possibly training teams to disrupt the arrest teams could be invaluable. Number 6. The greatest tool for liberty is your mind. Open it, take it out, and play with it. Remember, each of us has our own minds, but the state does not own such a tool. Conclusion. On the physical and economic levels, the state is an inherently unstable parasitic collaborative of politicians, bureaucrats, and select corporations, along with a subservient media, clergy, and intelligentsia that relies upon a combination of extortion, intimidation, threats, and violence to dominate its human host. In doing so, it distorts markets, stifles competition, discourages innovation, and through manipulation of the money supply and debt, siphons the lion's share of wealth into the pockets of a tiny group of central banking families while destroying a good portion of the wealth that it doesn't steal. On a metaphysical level, the state, whether real or imagined, is a faith-based deity existing in the minds of its believers, generally based on a combination of the adoration of a great man along with an illogical fear of a boogeyman in conjunction with an unblinking faith in the political process. That faith in turn relies on a dramatic opera-like performance on the part of politicians as they attempt to appear relevant, while the shadow government of bureaucrats and corporate banking puppet masters attempts to remain unseen. All the while, the state struggles to provide services it claims the monopolistic right to provide, while miserably failing at providing those services. On the occasion that the state's true nature is revealed and its failures exposed, it always responds by sending in waves of lies by actors on all levels while systematically discrediting, beating down, or murdering anyone who shines the light on those failures. The state relies on an incredibly delicate balancing act between the disinterest of its victims, the imagery of a functioning political process, and faith in government-led progress towards some mythical idea of a better tomorrow, in contrast with the reality of a non-functional puppet political process and an ever-growing, ever-consuming beast driving humanity toward worldwide slavery at best and species-wide destruction as a very real possibility. In the past, there have been four basic strategies for defeating the state, none of which actually provide a mechanism for defeating the state, while two of those strategies are either non-productive or, more commonly, destructive and counterproductive to our cause. This manual proposes a fifth strategy based on the idea that it is possible to upset that balance by simply waking up both the disinterested and the faithful public. This is accomplished by prodding the powers that be into overreactions while boldly proclaiming the failures and lies of the current system. This manual posits that this process is inherently dangerous as the state, having its basis in violence and hate, will react using extreme measures. Further, this manual posits that the primary members and leaders of the state will react in varying levels of panic and desperation as their positions of power become more and more unstable. Finally, this manual posits that in self-defense, specific activists will of necessity be required to take actions that none of us would like to think about. In self-defense, those actions will be violent, bloody, and will encompass the power structure of the state and its supporting apparatus. Concluding, this manual is a first attempt to motivate and train those brave activists who will accomplish this three-part task. This manual is not exhaustive nor complete. It is in need of revision and modification by those who are committed to this fight and knowledgeable of the processes herein outlined. End Part 1, Peaceful Sedition.
This audiobook, Sedition, Subversion, and Sabotage, Field Manual No. 1, A Three-Part Solution to the State, is written by Ben Stone. Learn more about Ben Stone at badquaker.com. That's badquaker.com. Ben's book and this audiobook of the book are covered by the BIPCOT No Government License. This allows use and reuse by anyone except government or government agents, because government and government agents are so square. Learn more at bipcot.org.
Worms.